What's up, everybody? Welcome to episode 81 of Into the Necrosphere. My guest today is Gavin McInally, the promoter of the legendary Damnation Festival. He's also the host of the Damnation Versus podcast. Gavin and I spoke about the ups and downs of podcasting, how he got into the promotion racket, everything that goes into putting together a world-class metal festival, and much, much more. It's a pretty beefy conversation, and we went all over the place, so I'm very confident you guys are going to enjoy it very much. Before we get to that, however, Godless Throne are a band out of Las Vegas who made me aware of the fact that they are going to be putting out a new record pretty soon. They've been around since 2016, put out an EP in 2017, but by all accounts, this new material absolutely blows away the stuff that came before. I am going to be playing a taster track off of the forthcoming record for you. This is Damnation Through Design, and it is my demo of the week.
Thank you.
Damnation Through Design by Godless Throne out of Las Vegas, my demo of the week. And if you would like to join their ranks alongside the likes of Master's Call, Born Ultra, and various undiscovered gems, then send me over your best work to intothenecrosphere@gmail.com or hit me up on social media. The show is on Twitter at iNecrosphere, at Instagram and Facebook at intothenecrosphere. And if I like what I hear, I will feature it on the show. And if I really like what I hear, you may well find yourself joining the ranks of Jason Mendonca, Alex von Malenvolt, Donald Tardy, Matt Wilcox, Sam Bean, and many others as a guest in the not-too-distant future. So thanks to the Godless Throne guys for getting in touch with me. I'll obviously post a link to that record in the or to the band, at least, in the description of the podcast. Go check them out if you like what you heard, and let them know that Jackson at Into the Necrosphere sent you. Coming up later on in the show, I'm going to be talking about the new Impaled Nazarene record, Eight Headed Serpent. It has been 7 years since Impaled Nazarene have given us or gifted us any of their music. I will let you know if it was worth the wait. I'll also be doing some news. In the meantime, do head over to the Teespring store and check out some Into the Necrosphere t-shirts, hoodies, etc. if you want your clothing style to reflect your impeccable taste in podcasts. And again, thank you very much to everybody who continues to support that. And thanks to everybody who continues to support the podcast. Those subscriber numbers are growing as we march on to episode 100. You know, considering how many podcasts there are for you to choose from, I just, you know, if you're willing to subscribe to the show, if you're willing to put aside 2 or 3 hours of your time every week to listen to it, I'm blown away and I'm massively appreciative, and I hope that I continue to make it worth your while week in and week out. So on that sentimental note, I'm going to welcome for the first time ever to the podcast, Gavin McInally of the Damnation Festival. So it was actually a long-time listener, Scott Bamford, that told me that I should get in touch with you and get you on the podcast, because I think he's a devout listener of your show and a likes of this podcast, and thought we'd have a fair bit in common. So I was going to start off by saying, listen to me, you son of a bitch. There's only space for so many podcasts on the internet. But I thought, no, if I pretend to be too serious about it, then you might not realize I'm joking.
People are too literal. I swear to God, I put up a post the other day about the pre-show we're doing for Damnation with the Orange Goblin, Svalbard, Ackercock, and Raging Speedtorn. And I made the joke. I said, you're not going to make us promote this. I mean, why is this not already sold out? And then straight away, you get somebody come in and go, shouldn't promoters promote? And you're like, for fuck's sake, internet. I mean, have a little bit of humor, you know?
It's difficult. And especially, like I said earlier, we'll talk about the experience of podcasting. But if you don't know somebody yet, that I find that feeling out process to be particularly, it's the one thing that I sometimes get nervous about, because it's always that you know sometimes from the first question, is this going to be a good one or this is going to be a difficult one? When you tell somebody, how's it going? And they go, fine.
Yeah.
And that's it. And you're like, fuck.
This is going to be tough if the next hour that I need to fill every... And we've got very different styles. You're very relaxed. And as you see, you like the conversation to go wherever the conversation goes. Mine aren't scripted, but at the same time, I like to fill every gap. And I always know what's coming next. Always know where, so I don't find myself drifting off into what did you have for dinner, you know. So I'm a bit like, and when I get especially a band member who's giving me those fine answers, I'm like, this is going to be tough work.
Well, that's the thing too, you know, you kind of lay the table as best you can. Listen, it's long form conversation. I always, the way I describe it is, this is Joe Rogan with metal people. And so, you know, like I said, I've even said to people, like, take the conversation any way you want it to be. You know, this is like two buddies meeting up at a bar and, you know, talking and getting to know each other. You know, generally speaking, if I've got somebody on the podcast, there's a good chance that we've got something in common. I'm not going to have, you know, fucking Ed Miliband come on the come on the show or something like that. I'll have people that I know I'm going to be able to have a conversation with. But yeah, like I said, I've been very, very fortunate. In 80 episodes, I've only twice had guests where, like, the first, I'd say especially the first 20, 30 minutes were like, this is going to be, I sort of eventually tapped on a vein where I could pull a little bit out, but it was tough going at the start. Yeah, but just for people that are listening, you know, in the US and places like that don't know who you are, mate, just give a quick introduction of you know, who you are, what you do, and your celebrity status in the UK metal underground.
Okay. I organise Damnation Festival and have done since 2005. Started in Manchester, it's now in Leeds. It's a 4,000 capacity, 4-stage indoor metal event, and for a flavour of the kind of bands, Carcass, Electric Wizard, Creator, Devon Townsend, Opeth, Mayhem, they're the big bands, and then it goes right down to, kind of bands that listeners of this podcast might know, and the Infernal Sea, we book Ward, the Antichrist Imperium, Ackercock a few times. So, it's a good mix. There's death metal, there's black metal, we've got grind, doom, my favourite genre metal is post-metal, so there's a fair chunk of that in one of the stages as well, like Amon Rand, Cult of Luna. So, yes, that's what... Seen in my eyes, anyway, is the third festival of the UK. You get the absolute big dog in Download, and then you've got your 15,000, 20,000 capacity in Bloodstock, and then you get Damnation at 4,000 capacity, and then after that, you've got a bunch of one deals and things that are kind of... I mean, Incineration's getting bigger. That's starting to become more sizable, but after that, there's a bunch of events that are what Damnation used to be, kind of thing. So that's my... And the reason that we're chatting is because in lockdown, I started a podcast to scratch the itch of doing nothing else music-wise, called Damnation Versus, and a spin-off on Damnation Versus Bloodstock. And I came across your podcast because I was interviewing Blake from Pig Destroyer, and your one popped up, and I thought, oh, this is interesting. Here's another guy doing the same sort of thing. So here we are.
You didn't think, who's this fucking asshole? Dislike.
80 episodes in, because I tell you, it's rough. It is rough trying to get people to tune in, even the best interviews. So I fair play to you for managing 80 of them so far, and well done, and keep them up.
Yeah, man. I let's get into the podcasting thing, because I absolutely love doing this, and I've said many times on the podcast I do this because I want to do it. I don't intend on making money out of it. I'm never going to ask people for Patreon donations. Nothing. I've got a job, but you know, it's a challenge balancing the day job with doing this, because it kind of, at least at the start especially, it's a little bit like business development when you kind of build up your interview pipeline, and then a couple of cancellations come in, and then you know you have to build up some more. It was quite a thing for me trying to convince people to come on the show and try, you know, convince them to kind of buy into the idea of, like I described it earlier, Joe Rogan for metal people. I would imagine it's a little bit easier for you, at least having the connections and some of the friendships and stuff that you already had established, right?
Yeah. I mean, I've only had two knockbacks, and all the people in asked, that was Jeff Walker of Carcass, who didn't want to do a Zoom. Basically, they didn't want to do anything online, and Joe Bench of Bolt Thrower don't do interviews and didn't really do interviews at the time, so that was no surprise. I was chancing my arm with her. Jeff Walker was a wee bit more cheeky. I mean, I booked his band a couple of times.
I was about to say, I was surprised about that, because he's been on your festival twice, right?
He's a contrary guy by nature, isn't he? He showed up at one of the death fests we put on with Brewería, the death metal band that he played in, and he tried to chuck the car keys at one of the crew. The guy couldn't even drive. he's got that nature about him. So I asked the question. He politely said no. But otherwise, no, you're right. There's some of the guests that I've asked, I don't know quite well personally over the years, or they've got a vested interest. I mean, if you're going to say no to me, come on, have a friendly chat for an hour, then ask your band, like, can your band go into Damnation next year? That's going to be a tougher ask. So yeah, I did have an easier go at getting the guest than what it sounds like you've had to build up.
Yeah, I think it's, you know, I was fortunate in that, because I used to write for Chronicles of Chaos and Metal Rules before, there were a couple of people that I knew. So I sort of leaned on that network pretty heavily.
Yeah.
And then what I've actually found is I'll just, you know, if I see somebody on Facebook that looks like I know them, and we've got a couple of mutual friends, I'll add them. And then if they accept, then, you know, usually that means, okay, they might be receptive to coming on. But I have started to find, I think it was probably after I had Ghoul from AM on, I think I started to find more and more people were open to it, and more people when I reached out to them had actually already seen the podcast. So that's sort of making things a little bit easier as well. But the bane of my existence, and I can't put you in a difficult situation where you land yourself in trouble with anyone in particular. And I won't name names, but I've mentioned it many times on this podcast, the bane of my fucking existence is record labels. With the exception of Apocalyptic Witchcraft, Season of Mist, and Deborah Mamorti, dealing with anybody else I find to be an absolute fucking nightmare. And anytime somebody asks me what the goal is for the show, it's not to have, you know, it's not to make money or anything like that. I don't even care so much about having millions and millions of you know, people downloading and listening to it. I want to get to a point where I never have to deal with record labels unless I absolutely want to.
Yeah.
So unless somebody I like, I want to get to the level where enough people know about the podcast that I've got a list of people that are keen to come on, who I can then choose from and say, okay, this person looks interesting, I want to speak to them this week, and that's that. Or at the very least, if I reach out to somebody, they know about the show, and it's no back and forth, talk to the PR at the label, you know, none of that shit, because I can't deal with it.
No, I can imagine. Fortunately, for whatever reason, I realized when I was doing the podcast, because I don't deal with record labels for whatever reason. Like, I deal with a lot of agents, I deal with a lot of managers, and I deal with a lot of bands directly, but for whatever reason, as a promoter, you don't tend to, or maybe it's just I don't have a lot of interest in record labels, so I haven't had, I've had the exact opposite. What happened to me was it Metal Blade or Relapse? Whatever one Paul Bearer's on, they reached out to me and said, would you interview Paul Bearer? And I was like, wait, okay, which was ironic because he was the least interested guest I've ever had.
Yeah, but yeah.
I interviewed him, and something was happening with that thing happened in America where the stock exchange got screwed over, and he was in some way involved. I really liked his story.
Oh, what, that GameStop? Was he involved in that?
He was involved in it, and he either had some money in it, or he was really passionate about the story. So I was having an interview with him, and he was pleasant, but he was like checking his phone at the same time. You're a bit like, well, I never asked for this interview. and the big man, he's a bit like, well, I've got other places to be. And I mean, I get it. The press at that record label were a bit like, well, here's another avenue to get some news out about Paul Bearer, let's do it. So he was just lined up for what in his day would be another one of 1,000 interviews that he's done. And I find that sometimes with the bands can be a bit more difficult to generate fresh content and interesting, because they've done it where I get agents on, and that'll be the first time they've ever been interviewed by anyone. And it's like the guy called Tom Taffon, who's agent for everyone, and he 2 hours of just absolute brilliant chat about what happens behind the scenes and why Download stopped that band playing this fest. When I was captivated. It was the only time I've ever asked to pause an interview so I could go and pee. Because I was like, this guy's fucking brilliant. So I've got a Dolpest manager on, Andy Farrell, and he was the same. It was a lot of stuff. By the time I'd finished the whole chat, I was like, there's so much more that I know than when I came on. Where sometimes with the bands, it can be a bit more of a drag. And strangely enough, Damnation versus the views and the downloads are higher on the people that no one knows the name of, the agents that no one knew beforehand, rather than the big name bands that you get on that don't do the same traffic for whatever reason.
That's another thing that I learned too. Like there's been a couple of guests I've had on where I was like, all right, this is the one. I expected at least 1,000 subscribers on YouTube. You know, I want to see those Spotify downloads through the roof after this. And then, you know, you get to like, because I post every Tuesday, so you get to Wednesday, Thursday, and it's like, what the fuck is going on here? Like, you know, does no one want to know anything about this guy?
Yeah.
And what I found is, you know, these sort of obscure people that nobody ever, you know, really interviews, they're the ones that everyone wants to see interviews with. You know, Alex von Malenwald of Ruins of Everest, I think that was a no-brainer. That band's got a big, they've got a big following. And, you know, he was, I could only actually find one or two interviews with him that were quite old anyway. So that was understandable. But then Andrew McIver of Code, I did about 2-3 weeks ago. And that was, I mean, just absolutely shot up. There was like, you know, 2,000. I kind of knew something was going to come there when I posted a photo of a Code record on Instagram. And I got just way more likes and response to it than I would normally get. I was like, fuck, do people really like this band this much? And yeah, people loved it. He was a cool dude as well.
Yeah, the bit that I watched about, I don't know, maybe 30, 40 minutes of that before I had Life got in the way. So that was good. That's the chap that was done in New Zealand.
Yeah.
And also, with Book Code have played Damnation, and there was a buzz. You get some bands that have just got some Imperial Triumphant, when we had them across when they did their UK debut as well. Just some bands get a right buzz about them that you might not otherwise have known. Especially in the black metal scene, some bands can. I mean, Magua being that example, where people just go fucking absolutely crazy for you.
So tell me a bit about this Magua incident, because I'll say just up front, I think this whole this undercurrent of fuckface that sits behind their desk and is ready to pounce on anything that they deem to be fascist or NSBM or I mean. They have this very loose definition of it. I saw this idiot, he does a zine or a website or something in Australia called Noob Heavy or something. I mean, it's just a complete fuckhead. He the other day published his massive list of NSNB or NSBM labels, and it was like Season of Mist, Underground, Profound Lore. It was like, Jesus, dude, you're really reaching with that. But
anyway,
be that as it may, I you know, I'm not going to go and fucking listen to Screwdriver or any stupid bands like that, but you know, when they start going like off to Taka or Marduk or Magua, I'm like, you know, come on.
Well, that was my experience of it. So we booked Magua in 2019 after years and years of requests for that band to be booked, and no one seen anything. And then we booked them, and then that's exactly what happened. Anyone who does know the story, 20 years ago in a completely separate band, one member apparently had an album that was translated free from Jews. And that's ultimately. That's the long and short of it. There's people try to pin other stuff to them, like, oh, they've done this with clandestine plays, or they were at a wedding with some Nazi, or they kicked a football in a field in Poland. And it's that yeah. whole guilt by association that people are really desperate to pin to that band. And listen, I'm saying this, I don't give a shit about Maguire. I mean, I have nothing to do with that band. I booked them one time, they played the festival, and then they left. So, as far as I was concerned, there's a bit like, this is a bit insane. There's Maguire been a bit for 20 years, and there's been not a single lyric, not a single instant, not a single... They don't even talk. They're going to go up on stage in Damnation, they're going to play for 45 minutes of black metal in masks, and then they're going to leave. Now, my event will not be used to promote any sort of
fascism. Well, that's the thing, though, mate. What's happening as they're on stage, they're subliminally sending messages out to the audience and radicalizing the youth as they play
the
their metal.
We get these things that people say, oh, no, but what's happening here is now you're normalizing it, and then you're going to make that easier for the screwdriver to come and play the Damnation next time. And I looked into it, bro. I took it seriously because I knew at that point that the reputation of the festival, I know how strong cancel culture is. So there's what happened basically is Antifa went after us. I replied in good faith to Antifa, and they published all my emails online. So everything, my views on it, I mean, paragraph after paragraph after paragraph, I went to everyone who'd ever booked Maguire in the UK. I went to people who booked him in Ireland and fucking down south, up in Scotland. People I know in Glasgow who booked him. I asked the question, are these guys, are they dressing room racists? Are the kind of guys that go in behind, like when they go in there and then you actually know, or like, and everybody came back and said, you know what, there's no issue. And then I went to the band directly because I could, because I booked them, and I said, the use guys racist. And they said, no, it's absolute nonsense, but we're not going to come out and say we're not racist, because that's just going to generate new headlines. Metal Sucks and Metal Injection and Brooklyn Vegan are all going to pick us up against the Maguire denied racist. So, and you know what happened after that whole episode and everybody threatening what's going to happen? Two people sent emails to Damnation. Two people were, and this was after they'd been whipped into a frenzy by Antifa. Antifa said, email Damnation and let them know you're not happy. Two emails came in. The day Maguire played was the busiest that stage has ever been since Bolt Thrower played in 2014. I think it was busier than when Opeth played later that night. There was no instances at all of anything at the festival that was reported to us. And you're like, what was that all about? What was that whole...
So the rumours of them telling the audience to line up with their birth certificate in hand so they could test their purity.
I'm not even there yet to be able to laugh at it, but because it was like, see, for 48 hours when I had an anonymous person at the end of an email address basically calling me a racist or a racist sympathiser or a left... or whatever these crazy terms that they come up with, racist adjacent, and I had to explain to them, in detail. And then when I was polite and courteous enough to do that, then would they repaid that by taking my emails and just posting them on the internet? And I mean, like, I'm Gavin McInally. Like, you can just stick me in that, you'll find me. You know what I mean? It's like, you can find my address if you want. You don't even have a name at the bottom of your email address. You're looking for some cordial discussion here between adults about quite a sensitive subject.
But that's where you're wrong, mate. It's not a conversation between adults, because if you see the way those idiots, behave themselves when they're in the streets, when they're yelling, shouting, and screaming at people, those are not adults having adult discourse. They're fucking mentally unstable. What I mean, I genuinely do believe that they belong to a cult. And I find their presence in this scene it makes me sick to my stomach. I mean, this was always a scene that for me was like freedom of expression, freedom of choice, freedom of ideas. You know, you came here because you kind of embraced that freedom. You were against the censorship and against all that bullshit. And absolutely, you know, there are abhorrent ideas that I think any sane, sensible human being doesn't want anywhere near their music. But as we've just said now, to make such a big scene about a band over something that happened 20 years ago, when ironically, these are the very same people that are talking about how you should abolish all prisons and everybody deserves a second chance. It's like, so they deserve a second chance, but if you find anything in their past from, be it 20 years, 30 years ago, that you disagree with, then they should be excommunicated from society forever.
There was definitely that, but then when I looked in, like, well, Sepultura wore swastika t-shirts when they were younger, right? And I was like, well, are we not banning Sepultura? Or is that, did they apologise for that? And then I was thinking, actually, as I say, I took it seriously. So what I was finding is I was contacting other promoters saying, oh, don't worry about Maguire. Band X are fucking rampant racists, and they're on everything because it's no public. And it, like, so basically, it's not about the racism. It's about the public-facing perception of it. Like, so it's not about the fact that let's actually weed out the racists that are there or deal with these or the promoters. It's the fact that this year's bandwagon to be on. So go, and then also that lack of any sort of forgiveness or any. It's like if you go out and you stab somebody and you went to jail for 5 years and came out and then played in a band, most people could accept that you'd done your time. But this guy at the time, listen, sounds like a fucking idiot, mate, like doing whatever he'd done back then, but he would have been 18 or 19. And it was like, not only was his entire career to be cancelled and never again should he make money for music, but everyone around him, the tour manager, the sound engineer, the fucking lighting guy, the label, the record, whatever, no one was to ever make money or do anything. This guy was to, and then where does it stop? Is that just music or is he allowed to work in the local Lidl? No, he can't work in Lidl because he's
fucking not a chance,
racist.
Mate. Because if he just works in Lidl, then all of Lidl and everyone who works there is also racist.
That, but no one was wanting, also, like, I found it was only a conversation that people wanted to have when there was a like and retweet button. See, as soon as the like and retweet button was taken away from the conversation, there was no public applause for that. As soon as you went through, because everybody wanted to debate it just on Twitter. But I'd say, look, well, I can have this conversation, I'm here. We can email each other. No, I would rather do it on Twitter, because if we email each other, well, either we'll take your emails and we'll make them public, so we've got, at least we can say, look what we showed the guy at Damnation, or just are not interested because there isn't that mob mentality of, look what I done, look what I got cancelled, look, I made this guy respond to us. And that whole thing was sickening, and it was sickening for me because I am even more, I'm a left, I am, my political views are left, I'm a left-leaning guy, so that for me, I've been a journalist for 20 years, I've chapped in people's doors, I've covered court stories of racists, I've outed racism as a journalist, and then I was the guy who was like, I'm the problem. I mean, come on, fuck me.
But this is the thing. This is the problem with the modern left, mate. Is folks like yourself, you know, who identify with you know, left wing policies or classically liberal ideas, get alienated because you've got these fringe groups, and the fringe groups seem to have the loudest voice, even though they're such a small minority. But I've seen it over and over again. I don't know whether you follow Tim Pool on YouTube, but Tim Pool's apparently a fascist, far right. I mean, the dude has always been to the left. He was an open Bernie Sanders supporter, you know, open Andrew Yang supporter, you know, massive supporter of Tulsi Gabbard. But because he dared say, listen, I don't agree with some of the stuff that I see in the Democrat Party, all of a sudden, fascist.
Yeah, because you're only as righteous as the person to the left of you, and then when but then the person, there's always one, because somebody's got an agenda, don't they? Somebody needs more. It's like you're always going to get someone who's more extreme than you, and if you're not as extreme as they are, then you're right. So suddenly it's like do you know the band Svalbard, the English hard, so their entire lyrics are about feminism and empowerment and against revenge porn and. So they were on the label Holy Roar. So then accusations came up against that label's owner. Now then, people were going after Svalbard about why we use on this label and he was there and you should have known better and you should have done this. Like, holy shit, you're getting a band that's entire existence is about equal rights and feminism, and now there's feminists that are attacking this band. It's like, and I had Serena on that day that they left the label on the podcast, and she described it as the left just eats itself. It'll just come back and eat itself. And
well, the best example or the best analogy I ever heard for this was I don't know if you know Majid Nawaz.
No.
So he runs he describes it as a think tank, or at least he used to, I think it's shut now, called Quilliam. And their whole mission was to de-radicalize, youngsters that had been kind of drawn towards radical Islam. But he stood, I think, multiple times as a liberal Democrat. You know, he's again, openly left-leaning guy. But what he said in an interview once that I listened to, and I was like, you've really nailed it, yeah. Is that, extreme left and extreme right always end up in the same place. Yeah. It always ends up in destruction. It never ends up in anything positive. And that's, again, I think that's what we're seeing happen right now.
Yeah. And for Damnation as well, we weren't looking for that fight. That's no, it's not what Damnation's about. Like, I mean, Damnation, if you were ever look at what would represent a left-leaning festival, Venom Prison, Discharge, Napalm Death, I don't know, like, so many Birds in Row, Dawn Raid were playing. So what was happening as well was, this is the sickening bit for the band. So you get 27 bands at Damnation and McGlar are announced. So what Antifa do, or people involved, I'm using them as an example, but people involved in this sort of let cancel culture, they don't go after, OPF never get an email. They were headlining the event. Primordial never get an email. They were on the main stage. Alcest never get an email. But people go after Venom Prison, Birds in Row, Dawn Raid, then the pressure's on them. Why, how can you guys possibly share this post? So, right, okay. So McGuire, you can't play an event with McGuire. You can't play an event with Phil Anselmo. He's racist. You can't play an event with Takia. And that's before you even get into the ones that are actually sinister. Now, you take out the A3 bands. You can't be a touring band in Europe. You can't play Brutal Assault. You can't do Hellfest. You can't do Vakin. You can't do... I mean, a push probably won't be able to do fucking Download, something that's commercial for that, because Down will probably be on there. You've went after these bands and tried to take away their livelihood and their passion and their ambitions for their careers because they agree with you. You've left the rest of the bands have just sat quiet. So you'd almost be better as a band just shutting up and just be like, well, you know what? Because you're going to get find this every single time. I don't know what the situation with Marduk is, but whatever that situation is as well, again, boom, you're done, because they're on every festival in Europe as well. So yeah.
So Marduk, I think, were cancelled in, they had Antifa cancel their show in New York, as far as I know. I think it was two venues in the US that they picketed and then it got cancelled. But I think the upshot of this is, I think what you'll just find is this parallel society will form, because there's, if you look at the if you look at votes across the UK as an example, right? There was this in the previous elections, there was this perception online, if you you use Twitter as your barometer for where the nation is, that this is going to be a Labour landslide, the evil Tories vanquished forever. And I mean, they won by an absolute landslide. In the States, it was certainly contentious, who won the election there. And there is a groundswell of folks that were previously sat on the left who now say that they either feel politically homeless or they vote for the conservative candidate because they just go, I would much rather be with this person, because the party that I previously supported has completely handed themselves over to the kind of woke internet crowd. I think ultimately what will happen is, I think, like I said, these parallel societies will start to form where you'll have your festival and you'll treat these people the way that, frankly, I think that they should be treated, which is when your child has a tantrum in a supermarket, you don't run up to them. What did I do wrong? What can I do to fix this? carry on with your tantrum. When we get home, you know, we'll have a chat.
That's going to be...
But you understand what I mean. I genuinely think, I think the only way to deal with this is to marginalize and just, you know, get rid of it. It's the same as the fringe groups on the far right. And I think eventually more and more people are going to get to that point, because, as you say, you know, if there was such a massive public backlash against you having McGuire on your festival, why on earth would you know, people be so into it when they played? Was it a gathered throng of 4,000 racists? Like, yeah, we finally had an opportunity.
Well, that's the truth is as well. The problem with that is, well, because it's that sliding scale of where you sit. The truth is there was people that are as left-leaning politically as me, friends of mine that might even be more into the whole Antifa thing, the demonstration, that, which is fine. I don't even share that view or when they're out there. Like, if you're out there and you're protesting Tommy Robinson's gang or whatever, then great. We don't see as much of it in Scotland because, well, we've got the Scottish National Party, the SNP are pretty down the middle, quite straight. I mean, I feel we're quite lucky we have that option. Labour don't exist in Scotland, and neither the Tory, actually. There's no other political parties in Scotland but the SNP, and that's okay. And then Also, with the Antifa, the West of Scotland is so entrenched in sectarianism and bigotry that no one really gives a shit if you're white or black. It's like, are you Catholic or Protestant? And if you're Catholic or Protestant, it's kind of what dictates your entire life in the West of Scotland. And racism is, people like will get to that, but you could take homophobia, racism, sexism, ageism, you could put them all in one bubble, and it still wouldn't be anything like what the problem of bigotry is in the West of Scotland. So, when you look at England, there's definitely issues there with the whole bit. I look at it and say, Tory or Labour or whatever, it's like, it's not our problem as much as Bojo is, I take it, still the Prime Minister.
Yeah, no, he's still the Prime Minister. I mean, mate, you know, again, when it comes to, I've said this on the podcast before, I'm very much, and socially at least, I'm very libertarian. I think people should get to do whatever they want. I should just never, ever have to provide. It shouldn't impact my life in any way. I shouldn't have to change anything about what I do. I should be able to live in harmony with someone, regardless of who they are. And they me. I should provide them no greater respect or consideration than I would provide anybody else. But what I would say, as far as racism is concerned, I grew up in South Africa during apartheid. I know what racism is, and that's part of why I find everything that I see so utterly laughable. It's like, if you're going to go pick out, you know, I mean, the definition of racism gets changed all the time to a point where you look at it and you go, like, what would you do if you were actually confronted by real racism or by real racists? Because you know, it would go so far over your head. I don't think you would actually be able to know how to process it. Instead, it's like back when the satanic panic was happening in the UK and in the US, and you know, the real evil bands were Motley Crue and Def Leppard and Poison and Metallica, you know, and in the meantime there was Bathory and Celtic Frost and Venom. You never heard about them. Yeah. It's the same thing. And actually I do personally think this fucking whack, you know, extreme left and extreme right thinking, I think that's what's replaced religion in modern society.
Religion
went away. Most people need
certainly not in the West of Scotland, believe me.
Yeah, like, no, that's true.
I'm listening to a lot of these points. This podcast became quite sinister and serious, as I say, I'm not downplaying any of it on for the record and whatever they say, but it's like it's your lived experience. As you say, you saw some extreme forms of racism. I've seen some extreme forms of sectarianism, bigotry, and it's weaved into our everyday life up here. And sometimes if it doesn't come with a groovy hashtag and it's not supported by America, people don't. I mean, Americans don't care that the West of Scotland's entrenched in bigotry. So
yeah, well, I mean, many of them don't care that they've got 3 million. Muslims locked up in concentration camps in China.
Listen, you're getting very like.
I was about to say we went down. We literally started and then went straight into the fucking drill down into the center.
I'm having a light-hearted time for a guy, you know. I've got a couple of cans here. I'm enjoying myself talking metal. I'm like,
I'll tell you, I get dark.
I get dark very quickly.
I could actually do with another beer. I might run across to where I keep them in my barbecue room and get me one in a second. But let's shift gears a little. Or less about the ills of society and more about damnation. So what kind of made you decide to get into this racket? Because I can imagine it's a stressful game, and I'm fascinated to understand kind of what the process is to get it up and running, how much work goes into what you do every year, because it's awesome to see every single year the festival seems to get bigger, bands get bigger, everything seems to get more. The impression I've always gotten is that everything is just a little more slick every year when it comes to how you guys run the festival and how things get done.
Yeah. Well, I mean, to your original, I'll start the question, but like to start it. So I'm not one of these guys. I didn't know or like metal at school or high school. I never had any idea about music. As I say, back to the whole, the only thing that matters in Pollock where I grew up is, can you fight? and can you play football? Like, no one, music's a fucking, no one knows that music exists, never mind being jocks and golfs and that jazz. So I was in college by the time that I'd heard of Limp Bizkit and Korn and Papa Roach and that kind of, that sort of gateway new metal stuff. And I quite quickly get into Raging Speedtorn and Amen. And it got, for me, within about 6 months, it got more extreme. And I was at the first couple of downloads. I was at the Ozfest, and I was at the first couple of downloads. I kind of got a bee in my bonnet about the bands that I wanted to see. I would be that guy that, you know, you get the memes and the videos about always complaining about the lineup. That's not the bands that I like, right? Well, I weren't doing that. That's what I was like in my head. But instead, I just go on the internet and sit at my keyboard and saying about how crap that Iron Maiden were and they should book Stamping Ground instead. I thought, well, I could just book Stamping Ground. You know, I could just do it myself. So that's exactly how Damnation was born. I think Bowling for Soup were booked for Bowling for Soup and they're stubbed, were booked for Download again. And I was like, enough's enough. It's I'll get three or four bands, we'll put them in a pub and we'll start something. And that's that first year snowballed. You could be booked Entombed and Raging Speedtorn and Sixth. And then next year it was into the Haunted and Acrecock. And then we sort of outgrew the venue in Manchester and moved to one university in Leeds, which wasn't very good. And then we moved to the current home we've got in Leeds University. And it's kind of each year, but it's always been a hobby. It's always been something to do. And I say it takes a lot of time. There is a lot of work in it. I mean, whether you're Damnation or Download, the mechanics behind the scenes are the exact same. The contracts, the agents, the managers, the politics, that's all the same behind. But so each year, we've just got a little less DIY and a little more professional, a little more just pay that extra money and get the folk in you need to do the stage management and the runners and the repping it and the bands have became a bit more tuned in yet. So that's where we're at. To the point you're booking Opeth, and let's be fair, Opeth are too big for Damnation. It's like, we can even fit them in the production they brought on the stage. It's like, Opeth are a band for Download, you know? It's like, but you're getting to that time of year and you want to do a UK tour or you want to get some dates. So like Damnation's a viable option for a band that size to Opeth and Mayhem are playing that year. They come across and get a decent fee and pretty much guarantee you're going to have a capacity room here, more than a couple of thousand people in the main stage. So that's the first part of your question. I don't remember what the second bit was.
Well, so actually you've sort of moved my mind along. I was interested to understand a bit of the politics, because I think that it's in my mind, I'm kind of imagining something that's probably 1,000 times as frustrating as trying to deal with a label to get a band on a podcast. I mean, you know, what kind of all enters into it?
Yeah, well, so what you get in the first instance, so what you would get like back in 2005, 2006 is like, prove your worth. Like, why would My Dying Bride play? Why would My Dying Bride play with this event? What's it called? Damnation? Why would they play that? So then it was like, right, as you say about getting guests, it's like, well, in the first year, we managed to get Entombed and Raging Speedtorn in Sixth, so they could do that, right? And then it's like, okay, well, here's the fee, and we want the fee 100% up front, and you're like, that's not how it was done, but back then, it's prove yourself, and then you get established a bit, and you move up a level, so then the bands are more freely available, and then you pay bands the way they should be paid, 50% a month in advance, and then you pay them before show day. So then that happens. And I think that ladder you'll always be climbing until you get to, I mean, end of the day, I can't book Metallica. I mean, even if I was to get a field that could get the capacity, Metallica aren't going to play for me or Damnation. So yeah, those rungs have always been a ladder, but there's that. Does the booking agent, does it like, so you get a band like, I've made use this example a lot of times with Pig Destroyer. We tried to book Pig Destroyer for all these years before 2012 when we first did. And the agent wasn't even replying emails. And then they changed the agent, and the next day they were suddenly available. And nothing changed except the agent. Now that's just a personal. That's just you sitting there behind that mic. You just decide you can't be asked replying to Damnation.
As soon as I see Gavin's emails.
The next day they get a new, and then that guy goes, well, I've worked with Damnation, or I like that, or that makes sense. Now, you don't know what goes into that. As a promoter, you don't know why suddenly they're available yet, or the years they weren't available. There's never an explanation. But it's apparent that on Monday they weren't available, and on Tuesday they were. And the only thing that happened overnight was they changed agents, you know? So yeah. there's bits of that. And then you get, there's exclusivity between it all. And as Damnation gets bigger, it starts competing more with definitely Bloodstock, and then sometimes Download. You'll get the bands that are playing Download's third or fourth stage, or a Dying Fetus or an Obituary or a Zeal and Ardor, say these kind of bands, and they'll be like, oh, we would do it, but we can't because Download have got us an exclusive. And then it's like for like, if I book Pig Destroyer for an exclusive for this year, like Bloodstock can't then go and book Pig Destroyer if they would. So there's bits of that aren't so much politics, that's just business. You know what I mean? Like, you're going to pay the fee to fly the band across for America and pay the festival fee. You better be getting the exclusive, you know what I mean?
It's very
different for the touring fee. If you've got that same band and they're doing 6 days in the UK and a tour bus, it could be half the price.
So in most cases, if you're getting a band from the States, you're having to foot the bill for the flight, you're having to foot the bill for, I would assume, accommodation and for their...
Yeah, for the second day leave anywhere, so United States, America, Australia, if you want Japan, if you want that exclusive, then you're paying the fee, which we already have a supplement on it for the fact it's exclusive. You'll be covering the flights when they arrive, whenever they arrive in the UK, you'll be picking them up, and ground transport, that's called. And then you'll be putting them in accommodation, and then it'll be ground transport from the accommodation to the event, and then it'll be catering on top of that, making sure they're fed. So, I mean, the catering, ground transport, sometimes hotels you'll still need to do, even if they're doing maybe touring in a van. But I definitely, for exclusives, that you'd need to put some hefty fee together to say, look, just take $20,000 and you guys do everything. You know what I mean? Which they might accept, but... most promoters will see that, okay, well, we can work this out for a wee bit cheaper.
I was about to say, so how much negotiation goes into that price? I mean, like, if I say you said, you know, on a book, you know, Jackie Smith's band, and I send you a price quote or whatever the case may be, like, do you then, are you in a position where you can go back and say, you're fucking insane?
What happens to bands? A big bugbear for me, and I've mentioned this a few times in my own podcast, the big bugbear for me is agents don't give you a price. And when I was talking to James, the guy who runs our tangent, there is no price list. There is no menu. You don't look, Mayhem, $20,000. Oh, what's that? Watain, $10,000. There is no price list. Everything is what the price you want to pay and what the band I want to pay for, and if he's can meet in the middle. So this is how it almost always goes, and it frustrates the life at me, is I go, let's use Mayhem again. Will you play for X amount? No, will you play? And if you will play, can you let me know what you need? And the agent comes back and says, what do you offer? And I'll say, well, what do they need? Because you know, I don't book Mayhem, so I don't, are they going to come in and do exclusive? Are they going to do London and Damnation? So you tell me, and they'll say, right, okay, We'll use the example of a tenner, right? Because I don't want to talk about band fees, right? So, say Mayhem want a tenner. What I'll do is I'll kind of know roughly what, so I'll say a fiver. And then the agent will always come back and say, you fucking crazy? Mayhem are worth 20. And then you go like, well, just start with that. Just start with that fee then, and then we know what we're dealing with. And what happens is you spite each, you haggle a wee bit. Sometimes people get really offended. Sometimes they don't. Sometimes you get the deal, sometimes you don't get the deal. But I always feel the best deals are the ones you feel you paid a little bit too much for, and they feel they came down a wee bit too little for. Like, you feel like you're properly haggled to something. And that's when I always feel you get a deal, because what happened with one band is I said, right, well, I'll pay 1,000. And the agent came back and says, no, they need 4. And I said, right, okay, I'll go to like 1.5. He goes, yes, perfect. And he just played me, basically. They would have definitely played for the first one, but he went too high and I never recognised it. And then I just kind of met him and he was like, oh, absolutely delighted, I'll take that. So you learn your lesson for that as well, because like these guys are all on commission. They'll take their 20% or 10% of the fee. They want the most for their band. That's the reason they're there. They do that for the band. That's why the bands aren't doing it themselves and believe that the agent's worth it. So there's a lot of negotiating, haggling, and then once you get past the price, then you need to start on the billing. And then the billings, who's playing here? Can we go over them? Can our logo be bigger? And it's kind of never ending, actually.
So what's like the most insane demand you've ever had from a band? Because I would assume, obviously, they would get into specifics around catering and stuff like that as well, right?
Absolutely not. But what happens is when you book a band, you get like a 15-page contract, and then within that contract, there'll be a catering rider, which is your food and drink, and then a production rider. And production riders are—you don't mess with production riders. Like, you give the band what they want, or you tell them what they can't have. Every band wants more stage time, more lights, more backline, more fucking more every smoke machines and fireworks and burning people on the stage. And obviously, a lot of that I just can't do. But you let the band know with that—that's a—I always feel that's quite that's very important, because that's the band's performance. They're coming here, they're doing that on your event. Don't let them show up and it's a different drum kit, or you said they could have fire and stage and they can't not. So we take that pretty seriously. The catering rider's more a piss take on their side, and like, we'll have that fight on a day, because if you get bands that are playing for £300, their catering's worth £500, you know? It's like four bottles of vodka, four bottles of Jack Daniels, £20 buyouts for dinners for 17 people because they're bringing fucking their niece who's going to be doing the merch, not the crap. So you get the catering riders more a wish list, as I see it. We always provide catering, but I don't think I've ever fulfilled an entire band's catering rider, even the biggest bands. And then but asking for stuff, sometimes you get bands like Watain, like that's not a piss take. They got in touch and said, we'll play Damnation, but we want this production. And it was basically the entire venue in fire. I mean, it was like everything was, it was something you could only do properly outdoors. And it's not a piss take in their part. They're like, this is the show we want to put on in the UK, but we can't find a venue to do it. And I'm looking at the production going, aye, because no one's going to ensure that.
Yeah. That's also a good point. So the more theatrical, I would assume, the more the insurance for the show goes up, right?
Well, the insurance is a difficult one, because it's like a public, like we're kind of covered with the venue. This is starting to get a wee bit more, insurance is starting to get a bit more tricky now with COVID, and who can be insured and who can't. And we're kind of looking into that and seeing what we can do. But we don't tend to have, I mean, Leeds University Union is not a place you're going to get pyro. You know what I mean? We can do video walls, projections. We can have all the best gear on stage, but you can't start setting off pyro and the venues are quite tight, they're quite restrictive. I mean, even the main stage, it's not a huge stage, even though you can get a couple of thousand fans in because of the length of it. So we've never had, you've had to say to bands when they've said, look, well, we want to set fire to stuff and set off flame cannons, like, it's just not possible. And a lot of them accept that because it's not been possible in a lot of the shows that they're playing. They're no Metallica. I mean, there's a lot of shows they play that they can't just, can I go to a 300 capacity club and then start fucking letting off fireworks? You know what I mean?
I think there was when I saw 1349 at the Gambling Underworld, they did flame spitting. Well, which that's is nuts, because you're literally like right up against the fucking ceiling when you're on stage there. So
aye, well, 1349 did burn a Damnation fan's face in 2007.
Oh, really?
Yes. Yeah, so what happened is we said to them, absolutely no flame, absolutely no fucking flame, you kidding me on, don't be daft. And that stage they played on fucking them, Cataclysm and Anonathrak was small, maybe, let's say 400-500 capacity at total. And apparently they done one of these sort of like the flame throws. I mean, it singed the guy, but enough that, fucking hell, man, you singed the guy's face. You know what I mean?
Jesus. Did the guy sue you guys for that?
No, thankfully, because well, if that had happened at the time, if he had sued us, I don't know if that might have been Damnation done by 2007. To be honest, he was thoroughly decent, and he wasn't hot. But if that had been America, that would have been.
Oh fuck yes! No, if that were America, you'd been screwed.
I'm pretty sure that would have been Damnation done. The guy probably. I said to him when I spoke to him after, you're welcome to a Damnation guest pass for life. You know what I mean? Because that shouldn't have happened. And but it's one of those examples where, well, I mean, there's only so much you can control. You tell a band not to do something, they go and fucking do it anyway. And as you say, that gig that you went to in 1349 doing that as well, you're like, well, did they get the clearance to actually have fire that day, or did they just go ahead and do it anyway?
Well, the fucking methane coming from the bathrooms is enough to get the place going. I don't know how often you went to the Camden Underworld, mate, but there was a point before they redid the bathrooms where, I mean, the bathrooms now are shit too, but there was a point right before they redid the bathrooms where it was literally like, it was like I don't know, War of the Worlds, after the fucking aliens have landed and they've blown up all the sewage pipes. It's just all over the floor. It was so goddamn disgusting.
I haven't been to London too often, thankfully. I'm not a big fan of London, to be fair.
How come?
I don't know. I've been doing for the Cult of Lunas Festival, the Beyond the Redshift, and I just felt it's expensive. Try to get anywhere's absolutely. I don't like public transport. But, I mean, you're kind of forced into it or paying £1,000 a taxi ride. And then the venues were all so far apart. I don't know. Maybe I just had a bad weekend in it, but I just felt so.
Oh, you're not going to be insulting me by hating on London, mate. I'm not the biggest fan either. I lived in Greater London for 18, 19 years. And I there are things about it that I miss now that I've moved out to the middle of nowhere. I really miss going to the Comedy Store. You know, for me, like, one of the best nights I've ever had in my life, and I've had multiple there, has been going to the Comedy Store. Just great place. The vibe is awesome. I obviously, you know, with COVID, there's not been any shows. I had some incredible nights going to shows, but the best nights were always at the Astoria and the Mean Fiddler, and those are broken down now. I feel like London just as a, it's kind of a microcosm of assholes, to be honest. And I just don't like being, I don't usually like being around people like that. And then the other thing about it, I completely agree with you. I can't stand public transport, and because London is so overcrowded, to have to, you know, cram onto the train and, you know, have your nose stuck under somebody's armpit, that's not my idea of a good time.
It was a bit too much.
I think the statistic that I read was that London was designed for 2 million people and it currently has 7 million.
I mean, my experience was just everything was so goddamn busy. And again, I mean, it's a bit like I went to New York and didn't enjoy New York. So maybe I'm just like this. For a guy, I'm a city, but I mean, I live in Glasgow. So it's not as if I'm on a farm myself. So, but you go to New York and I was just a bit like, is this what all the fuss is about? Fucking concrete squares everywhere. I mean,
we were going to go to New York for Christmas this past Christmas, and we booked it like in January of 2020, and obviously COVID happened, and now I've learned that New York is going back to 1980s New York. So I mean, even Mike from Tombs was saying that, you know, the place is just fucking rough now. You know, he was going to work, and he's like, there's these homeless people down an alley just giving you this, you know, Walking Dead zombie stare. And he was like, it's just, you just don't feel comfortable in the city anymore.
I will. I did take my leave because I went across for a UFC fight. I went to see Conor McGregor fight. So I spent,
I spent
the entire weekend in, every bar's the exact same shape. It's just a long rectangle. And the service is absolutely terrible, but they want a tip on the end of the service. So they give you a watered down Jack Daniels. It's about fucking that size with wee bits of ice floating at the top of it for $12. And then at the end of it, they say, oh, by the way, 20% tip. Like, this is actually the worst Jack Daniels I've ever had and the worst looking fucking pub I've ever been in. And the food is terrible. I know that's for a Scottish guy to say, but it's fucking onion rings and chicken nuggets. You know what I mean? Like, Americans have got this in their head that they've got a good food culture. No, they've stolen other people's good food culture. And they do it well there, but in their bars, it's fucking terrible. And I was like, this is what the fuss is about. The Conor McGregor fight was excellent, though. So
that was Eddie Alvarez, right?
Yeah.
Well, that was, I mean, as far as like the apex of his career is concerned, that was the very, very best performance that he ever put on. I mean, I was a Conor believer in that fight, but I thought that Eddie Alvarez was going to dismantle him. Because Alvarez had looked so good and he was such a legend and he had so much experience. I was like, you know, this dude is he's a great wrestler. He's a great all-rounder. He's going to give Conor a lot of problems. And it was like seeing the older kid, you know, the bigger kid in class take somebody's lunch money off them. It was just a fucking mauling.
It was mauling. The Irish in there as well. The place was fucking absolutely packed. You'd never have thought. And that's another thing. That Madison Square Garden, what's so special with that?
It's holy, like, ground, mate.
It's like this whole, like, oh my God, I'm in my, like, I don't know if you've ever been to Glasgow, but we've got a bit called the Hydro. It's easily better than the fucking, it's only been there for 5 or 6 years. And like, these guys are just get great marketing. Like, this whole city has just got great marketing because there's nothing special about Madison Square Garden unless you're a basketball fan.
Yeah. I've not been to New York, so I can't make any cast aspersions at it, but I you are not the first person to say that to me, and I generally speaking I'm just not a big fan of big cities. If I would love to go to the States, and I will go because with my job I'll most certainly need to go, but where I want to go is smaller places. I'd like to go to Austin. I'd really basically want to go anywhere where there's like a decent barbecue scene, and then I'm going to eat my way through that
I want to go to New Orleans. New Orleans sounds like a fun place to be. So, unless you're getting shot at, obviously. But, I've done New York, which it was just a really big Glasgow, and then in fucking California, which Jesus Christ, man, is people. You can't even leave a shop with people telling you you're going to be the greatest person in the world and have the very happiest day, and we really hope you're really happy for the rest of your day. Like, I know, I just held it for the hash up, man. It's like,
I was in Santa Clara, San Jose, and San Francisco 2 years ago. I really liked Santa Clara. I really liked San Jose. I thought San Francisco, I had an amazing meal there. That was the highlight of it. But walking in the streets there was one of the most bizarre experiences I've ever had in my life. Like, I've never, again, I come from a country where there's mass poverty, but I've never seen in the same vicinity as a, you know, super, super expensive, fancy restaurant, just a bunch of homeless people shooting up in the middle of the street. Never. This dude literally stood in the middle of the road. There's cars going past him on either side, spiking up. And then he was yelling at people as they're passing by. And then you think to yourself, well, okay, it's also, you know, I know the gun laws are a little stricter in California, but, you know, folks still have guns. So this fucking lunatic, with whatever he's on, there's also a chance that he has a gun. So I was just like, okay, just move.
Aye. It's quite a place, isn't it? Old America. Like, you know what? Because you've got, I don't have listeners in America, but if you get my listeners in America,
many.
I apologize. But what you need to do is everybody just needs to go to Italy. Italy's lovely. It's nice and quiet. The food's amazing. The accommodation's amazing.
Yeah, no. As I said, when I was in America, I had a blast. But I run my own country down. So
to be fair, I've just dismissed half of Scotland as a bigoted cesspit. So I suppose we're not heaping praise on anyone.
Yeah, no, that's true. Let's talk about fighting though, because I didn't realize that you're a fight fan. That show, by the way, the Eddie Alvarez Conor fight. That was also where Misha Tate won the belt off of Holly Holm, was it not? That was 200 and this was 203.
This is when she get battled. In fact, this one was only a good guess.
Oh, by Amanda Nunes.
So she get battled. It was Raquel Pennington, I think, that done all that time. She retired. Because that entire bill was incredible. If you remember, like, Khabib absolutely smashed Michael Johnson. And then it was the three title fights with Joanna versus Carolina. And Woodley was fighting Wonderboy for a belt that ended in a draw. And then Conor versus Alvarez. And then Yoel Romero smashed your man, Captain America.
Dickhead, Chris Weidman.
Chris Weidman, and bust his head open. So the entire card was insane.
Yeah, I'm just looking at it now. So Eddie Alvarez, Conor McGregor, Tyron Woodley versus Stephen Thompson, one of the worst fights ever, as was the rematch. Joanna Jędrzejczyk against Carolina. I'm not going to attempt to pronounce her surname. Joanna was such a phenomenal fighter, and it was she's one of those folks where the expiration date is there now, and you know that she's just never going to get to where she once was. I remember that Yoel Romero, because that was like that flying knee that he did.
Absolutely. So that was something else. And here's another reason why I'm probably being harsh in New York. At that time, so it's 2016? I think it was 2016. I've got the poster here, which is why I'm looking up in this direction. I'm 39 now, so I'm not going to do my, but I'm mid-30s. I could not get served a drink. I could not get served a drink in fucking New York. You need to have some sort of photo ID, which I never knew. So I ended up sitting beside this boy from Arkansas or Alaska, and I'm a bit like, listen, mate, come on. I'm all the way from Glasgow. I need you to get me drinks, and I'll pay for your drinks. And he's like, I don't drink. And I'm like, I don't care. I just need you to go to the bar and collect my drinks. And if you want to get yourself soft drinks, pretzels, fucking hot dogs, whatever you guys eat, you bash on, you do that. And thankfully he did. God, because that was also very frustrating, getting knocked back at bar after bar after bar for not being 21 when I was fucking 35. And also, Jesus. Look at me. I'm not a young looking guy, so
I was trying to think, when was the last time that I got carded? I know this was probably about 5-6 years ago. I was in South Africa on holiday, and I was going into a bar or into like a club with somebody, and somebody stopped me and asked me for my ID, and the dude looked about 17. I was like, "Are you fucking insane, mate? Something wrong with your eyes? I've got a beard. I've got fucking, you know, wrinkles. I don't look like I'm young."
I wish somebody said, "Matt, I've got quite a young look. My wife's only 3 years younger than me, but she looks a lot younger. So, and she's getting younger as I'm getting older." So it's starting to get to the whole dad and daughter situation. Come on, guys.
My girlfriend's 15 years younger than what I am.
Oh, well, you're loving life then. I've just got a young looking older woman. So
yeah. That UFC 205 card, was that not where the very infamous Yoel Romero, "No for gay Jesus," was... Remember when he did that speech I think it was Rogan that was interviewing him, and he was like, he was trying to say no forget Jesus or don't forget Jesus, but it was coming out the way that he speaks, like, "No forget Jesus, no forget Jesus."
Some boy, he's a bit better than him, but he definitely jumped. He done the whole Soldier of God thing when about the octagon at that time when they were doing it. But aye, that was quite the card. That it's been good. I've been into as I get older, the staying up to 6 in the morning to try and watch the big cards.
I can't do that anymore.
It's too much. I've had a few of them, especially for the corner fights. So you're like, but this is one we'll try and stay up for. But my Sunday's completely gone because I'm fucking broken. I've got three kids, but one toddler. So that's not on to try and do that. So aye.
No, that's been my problem with it as well. I can't stay up late. I don't enjoy staying up late because I have a busy enough week and life as it is. And so the trouble then is, okay, do I wait to procure it and watch it the next day? But then at the same time, then I can't go anywhere near my phone because there's fucking results all over the place. So the problem is I continually see the results of things, and so therefore I don't watch the actual fights. It's kind of like rugby has become like that as well, because I've got my daughter here every second weekend. She used to love watching rugby with her father, but she doesn't like doing it anymore. So now I can't follow the rugby as closely as I used to. So I don't really, I mean, there was a time where I would not miss a single UFC fight and I would not miss a single rugby match, you know, by anyone. And if I'm very honest with myself, it's been about a year since I've watched anything. I watched, the only fights that I always make a point of watching is Valentina Shevchenko, just because I think that what she does from a technique perspective, I frankly think I feel when I watch her fight, I feel fortunate that I am having the opportunity to see that in my lifetime.
That's what I felt about Khabib. See, when Khabib, I actually posted that on Facebook at the time when Khabib battered the life out of whoever his last opponent was, Justin Gaethje maybe. I was just like, Jesus Christ, and he retired. I was like, to see a guy do that. I mean, I know that style of fighting isn't for all the viewers. They don't appreciate that. But I'm a bit like, Jesus, he does it. Just that mauling, absolutely mauling another human, and giving them no space to do anything and controlling them. It was always kind of captivating.
It's like what he did with Edson Barboza. I'll never forget when Barboza got to the end of the second round and he had this look on his face like, I cannot believe I've got another 5 minutes of this.
I know. He done that to Michael. That when I saw him fight live in New York that time, he done that to Michael Johnson, basically, didn't he? Basically saying to him, "Look, just give up."
I remember he kept on talking to him. He was like, "It's not. This is not for you. This is not your
time. I don't want to hurt you. It's fine." He's a big loss to the sport. He was definitely.
I don't know why he didn't at least just go for the 30. You know, the 3-0. Because I mean. He is a problem for everybody in the lightweight division. There's no doubt about that. I don't know why he never, why just that one last one.
Aye. But I suppose everybody's got that one last one till they get caught, don't they? And then it's all like Tony Ferguson went from being the guy that was going to beat Khabib to now winning a 3 or 4 loss streak. I mean,
he's on a three fight skid at the moment.
Aye, so it can get quite quickly, I suppose.
Did you ever do any fighting or any MMA?
When I was not MMA, when I was younger, I was done five or six years of kickboxing. Well, what was it? We called it kickboxing, but because it was called some Jeet Kune Do or something, I had a wee bit of street fighting, a wee bit of kickboxing, a wee bit of sort of martial arts. Very practical stuff. There was no karate, no katas, nothing like that. So, aye, and I get right into it, but then, like every teenager, I just went in a different direction, drinking girls and music and college. Yeah. And I really like to be training 3 times a week to go and do a fucking roundhouse kick. Now, well, not really. So, I did get it. It was weird. If UFC or mixed martial arts had been about 20 years earlier in the UK, and when I was going through that phase, would have strayed off into one of those paths, maybe. But, that would be yourself.
You look like you still do a bit of training, though. Like, not you know, I obviously we're friends on Facebook. I saw your Daniel Craig Facebook profile photo. You got some well-defined shoulders.
I was like,
is this guy on steroids?
No, listen, if I could, be honest, because I don't compete at anything, right? So if anyone knows where to get those, then by all means, let me know. You'll be saving me an absolute hours and hours in the gym. But I was quite a skinny guy, played football for a lot of time. And then maybe in 2016 or whatever, I get quite into the weightlifting, the powerlifting. And I was about 12 and a half, 13 stone. And I went up to about 16 stone. But that takes a lot of effort. I was eating 4,000 calories a day, fucking training all the time, lifting all the time, getting massages all the time.
Doesn't take me any effort, mate. I'm fucking... I'm one of those people where when I look at food, I immediately start ballooning out.
It was weird because see, when you train that often, you train that heavy, it was really going to nothing but muscle. So I got quite big, and then I got a bit too big. That way you put a shirt on, and you just look like a fat guy in the room. I mean, yeah. I got a big fucking satellite dish face. So I was a bit like, and also you need to put the effort, I mean, to eat, because to get 4,000 decent calories, you need to eat your lunch, and then when you finish your lunch, you need to start eating a peanut butter and jam sandwich. And I was starting to get like, this is getting tiresome. So the weight, as soon as I stopped, because it takes effort to put on that amount of weight, as soon as I stopped eating like that, I started to come back down. But I still train regularly and keep myself in decent enough shape after lockdown, which was, I'd done nothing for about a year. So get myself back into it now, and nothing else to do.
Lockdown really fucked me up. I'm very openly admit I'm a comfort eater. So if I'm having a shit day at work, the first thing that I do is I jump up, right? Where's the ice cream? Where's the chocolates? Where's the crisps? So I put on about, it wasn't too bad. I put on about 10 kilos. So about probably 1.5 to 2 stone during lockdown. But, you know, I was probably inching up a little bit before lockdown as well, to be fair, because you know, you're in a relationship with somebody that you like, and the both of you really like food. And so you know, what you both love more than anything is just, you know, laying on your ass on the sofa, eating crap. I'm off to South Africa to see my parents in December. So I want to lose a good like 30 kilos before then. So it's going to be some serious work.
Get on it. It takes effort. You stick your weight on, take your weight off. But I mean, I've found that it's as long as you know, right? I get into it quite back a few years back. I get into it proper, like the actual micronutrients. I mean, like,
yeah,
what was in everything, like the amount of protein I was taking, the carbs, the fats, the good fats. So I got myself into some sort of understanding exactly what's in almost everything I'm eating. So by the time I decided I was going to lose the weight, it wasn't difficult at all. So my problem is the cans. My problem is sitting in these podcasts drinking 2 or 3 fucking cans of cider at a time.
I like me some beer as well, and I've got a real big thing for red wine. Like I've developed in my old age, I fucking love red wine.
That's my wife and I. My wife says if there wasn't the option of red wine, she doesn't actually bother drinking. There's nothing else that really bothers that much, but red wine, that both her and I are massive at red wine. But if I sit and do the podcast, which I have done actually with a glass of red wine, but I end up like this, and what did your band do next? The ciders are a wee bit more gentle.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's another thing that for me, I find beer hits me a lot harder than wine. I could quite comfortably sit here and probably drink 3-4 glasses of wine and I'll be fine.
If I had
more than 2-3 beers, you'd start getting me. I'm not somebody who gets loud when I get drunk or anything like that. I get sleepy. You know, back in my wilder days when I was working in London, there were quite a few nights when, you know, you go out with the boys, you get a little hammered, and then it's like at about, you know, 1 a.m. All right, guys, time to find a strip club. So you head off to the strip club. There was more than one occasion, I'm ashamed to admit, that I was sat, you know, right in front of the stage, fast asleep. I had a security guard like, son, wake up.
There we go. Like, I get your money, I'll leave. I do get loud when, but then I think I start loud. I'm loud when I'm sober, so I maybe get a wee bit louder when I'm drunk, and I'm definitely one of those sleepy guys. I've got guys, mates, that can just keep going and going and going, and I'm like, no, time to tap out.
It's never my life. I know I know people like that as well. I've got a buddy who, I mean, he's fucking half asleep at 7 at night, but then he gets to this tipping point and it's like 1 a.m. and he's like fired up.
Right,
time to go. I remember hanging out with him one night and it was like 3:30, 4 o'clock in the morning, and I'm literally like, I'm having to put matches in my eyelids just to keep them up, and he's like, oh yeah, the night is still young, and he's like, you know, more wine, turning the music loud. I wanted to talk again just about the festival for a second. So as far as like bands that you still want to sign, like what's the stone that hasn't been turned over yet, or the one name that you want to grab who you've not been able to get just yet?
It's weird because for me, if you're going to, okay, what's your absolute favorite bands? If you were to say money's no object, what bands you like to be? Nine Inch Nails, Tool, Deftones, right? Yeah. So that's the bands. Their bands are headlining 70,000 capacity festivals. So that's, if you were to say, your absolute dream scenario if you ran Vakin, Hellfest, Download, whatever. But I don't. So then it's like, well, what bands could you realistically book that you still have now? I've done most of them. Or we've done. And I'm talking on this podcast and I'm saying aye, because you and I talk. But I do have a guy, Paul, that organised. Damnation is mine, but I've got an organiser, Paul, who puts a lot of work in. And I view as a co-organizer, so I don't want this whole podcast to just be like, this is all I ever do.
Well, no, I'm gonna, that's going to be the headline. It's Gavin denies that.
Gavin shuns
his business partner.
He'll never listen at this point of the podcast anyway, so it'll be fine. But then when you get the bands, like, well, who could you have booked to you? They're like, Cult of Luna. Well, I've booked them. They've done a couple of times. And not only that, Cult of Luna with Julie Christmas doing the Mariner set, which is the be all and end all when it comes to Cult Owner, Amon Ra. And then if it was bands like, well, what would suit Damnation's audience best? Like, if you were to try to book a dream band for Damnation, Bulk Thrower. We booked Bulk Thrower in 2014. Carcass, we brought Carcass back to the UK for the first time in 13 years in 2008, and then we booked them again. Electric Wizard, we booked them 3 times. So we're in a weird spot now where's the bands now that take you that next level? Converge would be absolutely ideal. Neurosis are a band that we've chased and had a couple of times of being almost ready to do it, and then they're a band with a lot of moving parts. Emperor would be good. I know Emperor cost and trying to do Emperor outside London would be difficult. No, I mean, Incineration are really rolling the dice with Emperor, and they really need that to go, and I hope it does for them, because that's not a cheap band to get.
No, well, they've got the Roundhouse for that as well, which is it's a cool venue, the Roundhouse, but it's also a very big venue, an extremely costly venue also.
Aye, so you've got the cost of actually booking the Roundhouse, and then you've got the cost of booking the Emperor. So they're going to need all the support they can get. And I mean, the folk listening to this podcast are the kind of people that are going to go to Incineration. So, aye, let's say I had Stephen Moss, the organizer of that event, on the podcast, and he's relatively confident that they can make something happen. I think they, I think they saw their events coming into London and were a wee bit like, well, hold on a second, this is our patch. You know what I mean? This is, the UK can do this, but we'll see. It's a risk. Listen, black metal's not a, I've had black metal shows, I've put black metal on in Glasgow with Watain and Shining. They cut yourself Shining, not the other one. Mm-hmm. And they didn't do well. I mean, it's like, there's some big ass black metal bands that don't sell a huge amount of tickets in the UK. And that's a risk that the guys at the Incineration are taking. But then I suppose at some point you need to, don't you? You need to, if you want to move up to that level, you're going to need to take those risks.
Well, dude, the one thing that I'm super excited about for this year's Damnation is Acrococker doing Goat of Mendes. Now, here's a question. I know you've probably been sworn to a blood oath on this, but are they going to be breaking out the suits? Because I have told Jason on so many occasions that my opinion, I mean, that's they're one of my favorite bands of all time. My favorite album of all time is Corinzen, with no contest. But I just so miss the days of that band coming out with the white shirts and the black trousers, and there was just that vibe. I fucking love it, and I would so desperately like to see that just one more time.
I think so. My understanding with a nod and a wink is the band are having a discussion about the suits, about come back. Like, but I think the more that Jason and Sam and David see folk online saying, oh, they bring the suits, in. Listen, they're going to come up, right? And those bands are all playing pretty much headline sets. That's not an opener, main support. Like, I mean, Orange Goblin are technically headlining, but it's them and then everybody else. They're all playing the same sort of set. So you get more than 2,000 fans in that venue for that show, and those guys come up and doing that, it's a wee bit of pressure. Sometimes the promoters and fans forget there's a wee bit of pressure on the bands to actually pull out the bag. So
yeah.
If I was them, I'd be a bit like, fuck, let's get to pre-mart and get our suits back. You know what I mean? Like, we need to. As I said, nodding a wink, or we're having a chat about it, we'll see. But certainly there's nothing contractually to say that they either need to wear suits or come out in speedos. They can do whatever the hell they want. But if I was a betting man, I'd say we'll see some suits. I think that they're making the effort to go back and revisit that album 20 years later. I mean, the suits make sense, don't they?
Yeah, fuck yes. I remember seeing them for the first time, and it was I had heard a demo that they had recorded before Rape of the Boss at Nazarene. And it was a friend of mine who brought it back from the UK when he first went over, and he you know, befriended a bunch of folks here. He brought a cassette over back to South Africa, and I listened to it and I liked it, but it was never, you know, it was never one of those things at the time that was necessarily like my vibe. And then I remember, I think this was 2002, I saw Cradle of Filth at the Astoria. And at the time I didn't massively like Cradle of Filth, but I was probably more interested in Immolation, who were opening for them, or at least headline, or was slotted to open for them. But that night, Immolation didn't open for them, and these fucking suited lunatics came on stage. And it was like, I kind of didn't know what to make of it when I first saw it. It was like, this is so fucking violent and so, it's so otherworldly. It's like this thing that just sucks you in, you know, you feel like you're spinning in this crazy satanic black vortex. And I couldn't shake the feeling of it. And I actually wrote a review for it on COC, and it wasn't a very positive review, because I think at the time I didn't know what to make of it. And then I got Goes of Mendes and I bought Corinzen, and I was like, I'm fucking hooked. And I just, from then on out, anytime they played, I was always there. I've seen them probably 13, 14 times. Yeah. And those shows they played between 2003 and 2007, when it comes to extreme music, there's very, very few bands that have ever come close to creating that level of atmosphere with no pyro, nothing. It was just the way they were on stage just created this mood that was just fucking magical.
Yeah, it was good. We were delighted when, so it was 2006 that we had them headlining, and it was our second stage at the time, Downstairs and Jilly's Rock World. They had the whole thing. And that was a big, I remember being excited about that. I remember being excited about getting those guys and being their stamping ground, were playing before them. So it was that was a hell of a day as well. We had that Italian band, F.O. Duat. We had Senmo Paramedics playing. Some of the old Bills and Damnation
Stamping Ground, another band. I've got so many fond memories of that band, because there was a period of time where they were opening for just about fucking everybody in London.
Yeah.
And I mean, so many times they just stole the show because Adam, for one, is such an incredible frontman. He's got such a presence, you know, at that time. Yeah. I've seen photos of him recently and he looks like he's leaned out a little bit. But at that time, you know, he was muscled up. He was, you know, he would come on stage, he'd have his three quarters on, no shirt, you know, and he'd do the stage dive from the fucking, you know, from the amps into the audience. It was just... just carnage, and I loved it. I thing I've always loved most about live music is I love unpredictability. It's kind of like you know, where I love pro wrestling the most was in the, you know, in the Attitude Era, where you kind of never, you didn't know what was going to happen next. There's always this potential for chaos and craziness, and I've always loved that about live shows where you've got that, like. You know, where sometimes you see a band and they'll bring on like a you know, a guest vocalist, or there'll be like three vocalists on stage from different bands. I just love that vibe. I love that like almost like slight bit of sort of, it's slightly unhinged. You know, I've always loved that. And again, I think Stamping Ground, they just nailed that. Every time they played, there was this craziness in the air.
Tried to get him back for the Friday. I tried to get him back to do Calf from Empty Words. And its entirety, so they couldn't do it this year, but we'll see. Some of these things, you just need to plant a seed, you know. It's like Rage and Speedtorn weren't looking to do the debut album, Svalbard weren't looking to do When I Die, and Akakok, I don't know, at that point I was looking for an album because it was starting to get, that was the sort of theme of the night. So sometimes you just need to plant a seed. And when I say plant a seed, pay a lot of money.
Yeah.
And bands will come out and will do some special shows, especially at something like Damnation.
Yeah. No, dude, I think if you could get Stamping Ground to do Carved from Empty Words, it'd be amazing. Just have the paramedics handy, because I've seen so many people get fucked up when they play Officer Down. I mean,
people get fucking wiped out.
Oh, dude, it was always like that. Again, they were one of those bands that could pace a set perfectly. Like they never wore you out. They always just kind of like, okay, just a little more, just a little more, just a little more. And then all of a sudden you hear that, and then that song starts playing. And it's like, oh my God, now you know it's going to get really fucking crazy.
Absolutely.
The podcast, anything in the pipeline that I need to brace myself for, as far as, you know, competition is concerned.
So, just before I came on, do you know of the London band, the Math Grain People Slicer?
No.
There's your homework for tonight. There's a, if you like Dillinger Escape Plan, Converge, Pig Destroyer, they're fucking great, but they're getting a lot of hype about a very small band as we would see it now, but I think by next year they're going to be pretty big. So right before I came on here, actually, I was doing a podcast talking to People Slicer, and Katie, the singer, was making the point of fucking, you know, you're interviewing the person that organises Art Tangent, and interviewing the person that organises Bloodstock, and talking to Pig Destroyer and The Ocean and everything, and then now all of a sudden this wee three-piece for London. She's like, what are we doing here? But it's one of those things about lockdown that I've enjoyed the most. It's like, would I even have discovered that band if I hadn't been locked in, if I'd just been kicking about my own day-to-day life, driving backwards and forwards to work, dealing with the family, having the little time you've got left? I probably wouldn't have. But in lockdown, you're sitting here, okay, I'm working from home, I've got time to sit and listen to Spotify every single day. It's no difficult to plough through 10 new bands and find some crackers. As for the actual podcast itself, I made this point about on the Damnation Festival forum page, that I noticed that there wasn't the same interest in the Pig Destroyer chat that I had as there was World Industry Types, and I don't know if that's something that I just need to learn. If the fact that, like, at the end of the day, I'll come on and have a chat with anyone. I mean, I'll pick up the phone and just a chat one-on-one with somebody. It's not about particularly, oh, I need to have 10,000 downloads every episode or else it's not worth my time. It's a bit like, well, if Vicky for Bloodstock or James for Tangent are getting X amount, and then the bands I'm doing are getting a fraction of that, then maybe the listeners are just looking for that industry insider stuff. And then maybe you'll see if that's the case for yourself with this, because it's clearly very different for me talking about my inspiration for lyrics or what my next album is going to be. You know what I mean? It's like, there's not a lot of folk out there that are talking about bands discussions and tour managers and agents and the relationships that people have got. And that seems to be what Damnation versus niches. So maybe you'll be fine. We are bands, you're black metal and
I'm actually not all that concerned. My downloads last month went past 8,000, so that was the highest that I've done. And actually, I consciously try and have on 2-3 bigger guests, and then I'll try and have on like 2-3 smaller guests. So you get like Blake, or I had the Zoom masturbator David Ellison on as well. So you have like a bigger guest on, and then you have like a smaller band on, because the idea for me is always, okay, I can give the smaller band a rub by having hopefully a couple of new people that are captive or listening on Spotify or listening on whatever, you know, because they found it through the bigger band, and then, you know, hopefully they get introduced to a Cold Cell, or I discovered this band out of Los Angeles that I fucking love called Born Ultra. You know, so I had them on as my demo of the week. So it's stuff like that. That's kind of the idea for me. You know, I partly do this because I'm like you. I love having conversations with interesting people. I've been very fortunate that I've made some good friends as well, I think, over the course of doing this podcast. So that's fun. And actually, it's in a way for me, it's kind of a way to kind of keep in touch with friends, because I don't have time to have a proper conversation with people, you know, every other week. And it's a shame to let some of those friendships go away, because that stuff has real value to me. So I you know, now when I have somebody like you know, like Matt Wilcock on, or Mike from Tombs, it's just catching up with a mate. You know, but hopefully for the entertainment of whoever watches the show. Yeah. But then also the other thing is hopefully making it so that a couple of bands get some recognition and get some exposure that they wouldn't otherwise have gotten.
I've definitely seen that. I never knew that certainly wasn't any motivation behind it to get it. But while I would go on, I'd be sitting saying, like, Amon Ra, Amon Ra, Amon Ra. And then people would be contacting me, say, oh, fucking hell, I checked out Amon Ra. And they're amazing, or maybe she will. I have been taught about Pupil Slicer a lot recently. And people are checking it at them. They're like, okay, that's become a byproduct of it. The whole sort of like, you're giving these bands a bit of rub that you weren't even expecting. Because I'm looking at saying, well, why would folk listen to me? But then people are like, well, we'll listen to you because you've done 15 years of these fucking great festivals. And we've came and seen these bands and found all these brilliant new bands that we liked. So that's why we're listening. So there's a wee bit of that as well. And in terms of with the podcast, I find if you can hit a newsline, you know what I mean? Like, if you can get, when I had Serena Fesvalbard on, that Serena Fesvalbard's done more downloads. She just took over Nathrak recently. And I got seen on the day that they left Holy Row Records. So people were clearly they were interested in James's one for Art Tangent when they were just announcing they were being cancelled. That done well as well, because people were looking for that content, or people were interested, like, why is that the case? So there's a bit of that as well that I quite enjoy if we can get them out quick enough. I kind of do them on the fly. Your whole setup, even by the look of yourself, is a lot more professional. And even your fucking link you get to come through to yours, mine's is like that second. If I'm due to speak to you at 7 o'clock, I send you a Zoom link at 6:59 and say, click that, and you come through. And there's a wee bit more of that. It's like, if I can speak to somebody at 6 o'clock on a Thursday night, between myself and Bri, who packages the whole thing up, we can have it back out by 8:30 that night. I mean, there's no editing. There's no, you cut it at the start, cut it at the end, slap it in a nice package, and we'll just put it straight out. So there's a bit of that if I can get my hands on it. I've been trying to get somebody for download to talk about this whole situation they've got with a pilot event. But they understandably don't seem that keen.
Well, mate, it'll happen soon enough. I mean, you know, I'm very realistic with myself. There's a fuckload of other podcasts around. I mean, I think during the lockdown there were at least probably a 1,000 more added. So, you know, if anybody takes the time to listen to anything that I'm doing, particularly people that listen regularly, and there's a fair few of them now. Fuck, man, I'm blown away. I can't believe that
it's easy to get into that. You can look at YouTube, right? If you look at YouTube and you see that home screen, the Fortnite videos and the UFC videos and stuff, like 17 million views, 24 million views, 100 million views, and that's all you see. It's like that perception of that's what happens in YouTube. But the truth is, like, well, download, they've got a podcast called, I can't remember what it's called, but there was an interviewer interviewing a person for Clown for Slipknot, and it was there yesterday, we did 9,000 views. Like, well, there you go, you've got the biggest festival in the UK, with one of the biggest bands in the world, and it's done 9,000 views. Well, here's Gavin for fucking Damnation, or yourself for the Necrosphere, and you're sitting there going, well, you've got a few videos now that have done 2,000 views. Like, that's a good show. That's a good.
Well, the thing is also, if you do long form podcasts, mate, I don't know about you, but I don't sit in front of YouTube watching a fucking 2-hour video. I've got better things to do with my time. So when I listen to podcasts, it's when I'm at the gym, and I usually use Spotify for that. So I'll just go on Spotify, load up whatever podcast I want to listen to, and I'll do it there. So that, I mean, my YouTube is kind of like I know a lot of folks that don't even use it anymore. I use it in part because if I edit together the episode as a video, I just rip the audio straight off and I upload it to Spreaker. So that's how I have the audio version. But as far as the traffic that comes through on the audio version, it's way, way higher than YouTube, and understandably so. People are busy going on with their lives. I kind of tend to see this. I'll see a sort of a swell of people that discover the show on YouTube, and then the very next week it's like they're gone. And then I see almost exactly that number has moved to Spotify, or they've moved to Apple Podcasts or something like that.
Somebody else to pick it up. Yeah, exactly. But the point I was getting is you need some sort of context. I saw at the very start, you're a bit like, when I'm putting this out, and is he going to do Joe Rogan numbers? There's no context. You don't know what anybody's going to do. And then it was the World Metal Congress, something like that. It was one podcast that was like Walter for Roadburn, and it was Murker and like the editor of Metal Hammer, and that was only going out on YouTube. And it's like, so it's 250 views or something. You see, right? Well, that there's your context. There's your actual context of where things are. And I've been lucky, I've been fortunate enough that sometimes that Damnation Versus and Damnation Versus Bloodstock made the charts in Spotify and iTunes. So you're a bit like, right, well, I know what the numbers are. So I know that some of the biggest podcasts, it's more like they're getting 40,000 downloads every single one. Like, just because Joe Rogan's getting a million downloads every time he coughs, it's just that's not going to happen. You know what I mean?
So yeah.
But, and then also, if you really got it, like, I'm paying for this. I'm paying for the hosting fees. There's no sponsorship. I'm no looking for any money from it. You can get realistic. It seems like playing amateur football. It's just it's a bit of fun. You're paying your tenner, you get your game, and that's you.
No, exactly. So, but I mean, you look at Jamie Jaster's podcast, and Jamie Jaster's show is, you know, arguably one of the biggest. So the last couple that he's done, right? Clint Lowry from Seven Dust. Okay, that's 5 hours old, but 181 views. Miles Kennedy of Alterbridge. Alterbridge is fucking massive. Not a band I like. 1,200 views. Rudy Sarzo, 769 views. That's a week old. You know, and then it goes on. He's got like his Fight Buddies podcast, 461.
Aye.
So it's kind of, I mean,
you can start to beat yourself up a wee bit if you allow yourself to go down that hole. Oh, my son's watched a Fortnite video and it's got 17.2 million views.
Like, that's a ticket, mate. I was about to say that's the hack that I thought with a show. Do like one barbecue video, push up the subscribers by about 1,000 straight away.
Do one reaction. Pick a black metal song and do the reaction. You're just looking stunned at the fact that there's some blast beats, and then there's your dinner sorted.
Well, that's the thing too. That's one thing I don't get about YouTube. Why do all these Christians react videos get so many fucking views? It's like there was one the other day where they were doing Becoming the Adversary by Akrakocka, and it was like 37 or 38,000 views. It's like, I don't think if Akrakocka posted that song, or made a video and posted that song themselves, they'd get that much.
I know. It's bizarre. It's bizarre. But you just need to connect it. You get like, I read, before I get started, I read the best thing, like, treat starting a podcast the way you would treat starting a band. There's going to be one out of 10,000 that are ever going to make any money to them. There'll be one out of 10,000 that ever make any money doing a podcast. And I was a bit like, well, great. What does it cost? $18 a month or something for the hosting fees? And that's fine. I'll do that. Right. I've been sent more than that in vinyl. Like I've had bands that have sent me vinyl stuff, but like, well, you know, but that can be my payment for my time and effort. Some vinyl for the record player or a free T-shirt. So I've really enjoyed it. I feel that I've probably learned a bit more than I've even accepted at this point about the industry that I'll take with me into Damnation. And relationships are probably, because what I find with the Damnation versus is the audience's exit. Another thing that I'd read that made sense is if you had a technology podcast and you only had one listener, but that listener was Elon Musk or Elon Musk, you would fucking do it, wouldn't you? You would do it. And that's the thing, the quality of listeners for Damnation is all the other festival promoters, it's all the agents. So, I mean, a lot of fans as well, obviously, but I'll get people that don't say, call me, don't text me to say they're listening to it. And then they'll say, oh, any chance I can get band X on the podcast because they've sat and listened to the first 7 episodes. So there's a wee bit of that. I think there's some advantages in like brand recognition. It sounds a bit American and a bit wanky about it, that about Damnation that I've not even appreciated yet, that the podcast is.
Oh, as you say, mate, you have a 15-year legacy of putting on a consistently quality festival with consistently strong lineup. So of course it's going to have a... you know, of course, that there's a degree of cachet that comes with the brand.
Yeah, I hope so anyway.
I've got something special in mind for episode 100 though. I had a couple of different ideas, but I've come across one which is Acrococker related. So I've spoken with David, and I know he's up for doing the show, but he wants to do it in person.
Yeah.
I was kind of racking my brain thinking, how the fuck am I going to do this? Am I going to actually shell out for a camera and you know, go down to Kingston and do it properly? I'm going to rent a studio, so I'll do something. I was thinking it's probably the best thing to do for episode 100 because there's no fucking way I'm renting a studio for every episode. But yeah. I might do something like that. So that's a scoop for folks listening. That's the plan. I mean, if it doesn't happen, it might not happen, but hopefully that'll be the plan to get him on at some point soon.
But the thing is, well, if you can get yourself in a studio, that'll allow the opportunity to do even more than one guest. If you were to get, I mean, David and Jason, or David, Jason and Sam, or whoever.
Well, that was my thinking, actually.
You could do it that way.
Jason doesn't live a million miles away from me, so yeah. But I would actually like to do just one with David, because I've had Jason on, I've had Sam on, I've had Sam on twice. I was thinking of just using the studio time and asking Sam if he wants to come over and talk some shit after that. So.
And by all means, if you get the studio time, we do it, because that's the, I mean, as I say, the one I'd just done before I came on here, like Pupil Slicer, that band I like to do it was normally the three of them and then the host, but I watched a couple and it always ends up people talking over each other and then the mic's cutting out and then somebody lags and the next thing you know, you're watching sort of four screens wondering what's going on. So I had to say to the singer, like, Katie, as much as I'd like to speak to the Josh and Luke, let's just one ease do it, because it can be difficult enough sometimes when you get a bit of lag with one guest, never mind try to do that with three, and then it'd be a wee bit like, right, whose turn is it now to talk? So if you, I mean, in a studio would be fantastic, because that just doesn't exist. You talk over a wee bit each other in a studio, it would make no difference. So
which is also, you get when you do this a real appreciation for people that do this as well as someone like Rogan does it. I mean, he's one of the masters. He's exceptionally good at it. I'll tell you another guy, two people who when they're together on a podcast, it is absolute magic. And I don't know if you know who they are, but Brian Callan and Chris D'Elia.
Yeah.
So whenever
I know who Brian Callan is. Yeah.
So whenever they did The Fighter and the Kid together and it was just them, so Brendan Sharp, who's the other co-host, wasn't there. I mean, that is literally 2 hours of just pure magic, because they are laying into each other and taking the piss out of each other for 2 hours straight. And I've had situations where I've laughed so much that I would have to stop midway through a set, or like I'm driving and I literally have to like turn the volume down because it's like, I'm fucking sobbing with laughter. I can't see what's going on in front of me anymore.
I know about the Fight on the Kid, so I'll definitely give that a shot. No, the thing I did appreciate the fact to yourself is like, see the 1 hour, 90 minutes, 2 hours of just unedited conversation, that's fine. I can do that. 22 episodes in with everything, that's fine. But see 15 seconds of a monologue, see 15 seconds of me trying to go, oh, in this episode, I had to do like 10 takes to say, like, hi, this is Serena from fucking, what is that? And the whole thing was a mess. And I just decided by the time I started season 2, I'm not doing it. I'm just not doing it. I'm like, because I was spending more time trying to record 15 second intros than I was doing 2 hours in a chat with somebody. Just because I think it's a skill. And when
I saw you sitting doing that for
30 minutes, I was like, hey, good for you, pal.
when I do the news. So when I do the news, I just hit my stride and I can just rant and rave like a fucking lunatic for, 25-30 minutes. And it's funny because I can see the drop off when people aren't listening anymore. I lose a good 70% of people just before the news. So
yep.
I know that the people listening during the news segment are the hardcores.
Yeah.
I feel like I can let loose a bit more, but I probably enjoy that as much as anything else about the podcast, frankly.
Yeah.
But the news is fine. It's always for me the opening intro is the one that I find difficult. And some mornings I'll sit down here and I'll start recording it and I'm like, I'll get to like take 5, take 6, and I'm getting so fucking angry. Like in between each one, I can feel myself getting more wound up. And the more I'm getting wound up, the more difficult it's getting. And then other mornings it's just like one take and I'm done.
Easy. Aye. No, that was the one thing. Season one, so anybody ever listens to them, the first 10 episodes, I've always getting a short introduction. And then by episode one, I was like, fuck that, right in the bin. So no more than them.
The problem is, I think maybe your brain probably works similarly to mine. I get ahead of myself. And that's when I start fucking up. Like I get ahead of myself. So then I lose my train of thought. And then I'm like, okay, how am I going to phrase this? And then I hear the words coming. As soon as you start hearing the words coming out of your mouth, then you know something's wrong.
Yeah.
Everything kind of needs to be, I don't know if I'm describing it properly, but everything needs to be in sync to where you're completely in the moment. Your brain and your mouth are operating at roughly the same speed. And you're just not, you're not losing that. It's so easy to lose that. And then when you lose it, you start becoming self-aware. And when you become self-aware, like I said, there's that gap between, okay,
there's
my brain's thinking ahead of what my mouth is saying.
One take. Like, as you, we're here, we slip up, whatever's done, it's done. You know, you make a mistake, aye, fuck it. I mean, because there's been plenty where I've misspoken or said something or said the wrong agent's name, whatever. You're like, oh, Jesus, if I had any control over this, other than going back and editing it, which I'm not going to do, I definitely would. If this was a case I could just stop and start again, I definitely would. But when you know you can stop and start, or something about that whole, you feel you need to reach some level of perfection you're never going to get to. So then you just stop and start. But as if it's just a chat, like you've been going for the best part of 2 hours, and you're just a bit like, okay, well, it's when you make a mistake and you fuck it up, or some bit is dipping, and then that's just the way the conversation goes.
No, I had Dallas from Nile, formerly of Nile Narcotic Wasteland, on the other day. And it was like second take of the intro, and I was like, blah blah blah, coming up next, Dollar Wade. I was like, what? And I didn't even edit it out. I was like, Dollar, what the fuck? I was like, Dallas Dollar Wade. So cool guy, but he was an interesting guest. I had a couple of folks message me and like say, like, I could tell you had to work a little to get him to loosen up. And the thing is, I get it. There's certain people where, like, I know if I Phil Anselmo is one of my absolute dream guests. If I ever had the chance to talk to him, I know the guards are going to be up for a little bit, because he'll be expecting the same old bullshit. Like, so tell me about your time with Pantera. Now, what about Dime? What about, I mean, all the usual crap.
Yeah.
With Dallas, it was definitely that, because you kind of, you know that he's expecting me to ask about Niall and why he left the band and, dig for gossip and stuff. I, by the way, was shunned by one person. So I've had two people turn me down. One was Sarkis of Rotten Christ, who I've met twice before, got on really, really well with. Fun fact about him, when 7/7 happened, the first person to contact me and ask me if I was okay was him. But he didn't do it because he didn't want to be on Zoom. He's like, he's flat refused. Like, I just don't know how Zoom works. I don't want to be on Zoom. And then the other person was Vicky from Bloodstock. But that was literally almost straight after I started the podcast. So I must have had about fucking 10 followers on Instagram. I can imagine what she thought when I messaged her going, I do a podcast. Which is like, basically Joe Rogan for metal people.
Try not to be too offended. I mean, I actually have a podcast with Vicky. I mean, I have.
I know. I listen to it.
Damnation versus Bloodstock, and I can barely get her for her own fucking podcast. Like, Vicky, we've got another podcast. She's like, right, definitely my fault, Gavin. Next time, like, you fucking, And I mean, she's a co-host and I kind of get her, so I would try not to be too offended. But if
no, I no, dude, no, not at all. And like I said, I mean, I can imagine between the pervert shit and the all the other lunatic crap that she's going to get on Instagram. That's another thing I've been fortunate about. You're talking about like quality of audience. And I think I've been unbelievably fortunate with a show where I have, to this day, never had a single message sent to me by someone where I go, who the fuck is this? Like, you know, almost everyone is super positive, super nice. I feel like, you know, and that's another thing that I maybe take away from it that's been a real kind of benefit that I didn't expect, but I feel like I've built this organic audience around the podcast that is very like-minded to me. And generally speaking, everybody's very, very cool. And, you know, nobody's difficult. Everybody's super positive, very encouraging, very enthusiastic. And that is just, that's awesome. And as I said, I never in a million years expected it to be what it has turned out to be.
Yeah. I mean, if you get a situation where you've got, you're interviewing one of those fans' favorite bands, and it is, you're asking them different questions or you're getting some different sort of content. And I mean, at the end of the day, you're right, it's free. You're putting the time and effort in. I mean, it's like, for somebody to come on and be a bit shitty, but you're like, well, I know, yeah. I'm a wee bit like, any feedback's good, you know what I mean? Fucking bring it. And I mean, like, if you don't like it, you don't like it. It's fine, but it's like, I thought it'd be a bit worse than YouTube, because I'd heard about the whole YouTube comment section trying to be the most fucking horrific as it can possibly be. But I'm the same. Although I have to say, it wasn't until I got my first thumbs down that I genuinely felt I was on YouTube. I was like, can I almost give myself a thumbs down?
I waited until, so I got my first thumbs down on episode 13. And it was weirdly enough for Matt Wilcock. And I was like, was it even 13? It was like 23, I think, that he was on for the first time. And I made a point of saying on the next episode, whoever you are, fuck you.
I was a bit like, come on, where's my thumbs down? YouTube can't put, you can put, you know, there's often kids giving it sweeties in videos that getting thumbs down. I mean, like, I need my thumbs down.
That's the real fucking scam I'm pissed off I never got onto. My daughter used to be so into it as well, like Baby Big Mouth and all that crap, where it's like literally people filming themselves with a GoPro opening up a toy. And it's got like 6 billion views. Can you imagine the amount of money those people are making for literally having like a little toy car or something, like taking it out of the wrapper and then sounding and talking over it like a moron, you know, like narrating it like, oh, opening up a toy car.
Never just sound the jealous, right?
Were your kids into any of that nonsense?
The thing is, both my kids, I've got my son's 11, 12 maybe, one or two, and my daughter turns 11 tomorrow, so they are in YouTube, and it's, Niall is all Fortnite tutorials, Fortnite videos, Fortnite playthroughs, and Cadence is more, that not so much opening the presents, but like, oh, this is a squishy or a squashy, and look at me paint it, and like, and this girl in America, I mean, like a woman, maybe 18, 19, and she's made a complete brand at that. I mean, now she's got a full merchandise range, and they're like, fair play. I mean,
yeah,
fair play. When they've done, painted a couple of squishies, like, when she's finished painting them, they still look pretty shit. They're not that good. It's not like, I'm not into my daughter, it's like, you could probably do that. So
Yeah. No, my daughter, I've weaned her off of that pretty quickly. So she's 7 years old now. This weekend we watched Kong Skull Island for the first time, and she fucking loved it. So I was like, okay.
Oh, my youngest. She's like, you ever go into the Peppa Pig videos? The ones that are just like streaming.
And they've
got like a billion views as well. So she climbs into bed and the mom goes, "Daddy, Peppa Pig," and you're like, You try to get a phone or an iPad or something, like, hit my wife, can somebody grab something for Charlotte?
So, dude, have you ever been to, have you ever taken them to Peppa Pig World or a place like that?
Not yet.
It's like when Peppa comes walking out, those kids act like they like, you know, they've just seen Jesus. It's literally like they start making these weird sounds like and their hand reaches forward for what's a pepper. I remember it was like they had to have a security guard just to make sure that the kids don't over hug him, because it's like they run up and then they hug him, and then it's like, okay, get to the back of the line if you want to hug him again. The next one comes in.
The money making schemes that we have. Here I am trying to put on a fucking festival for pennies, but I mean, and all I had to do
was learn how to paint a squishy.
And I'll dress up as a Peppa Pig.
Yeah. I just had one thought, a band that would be fucking cool for Damnation. Not black metal or death metal or anything like that, but I reckon the fans would still like it. Killing Joke.
Killing Joke are one of those ones. They're up there like Ministry as well. You know, it's like something a wee bit left field for Damnation, which may happen at some point. It's a bit like, aye, we need to try something. I mean, because, as I say, that pool of your Electric Wizards, your Carcasses, your Paradise Lost, I mean, that's been drained. You know what I mean? We've done that.
Paradise Lost has never drained, but...
Well, let's see if I can get Paradise Lost doing Gothic. That would be...
Oh, mate.
That would be a show.
Well, Gothic, get them to do Gothic and Shades of God back to back.
I mean, Gothic just isn't enough. No, okay.
No. that's another band where I've seen them many times and I've never ever walked away bored. I've always been blown away. They're one of those, they're so understated when they're on stage. It's like they don't really do anything. I described them the other day as like they're basically just old men standing around on stage making good music.
Aye.
But they do that so fucking well.
Aye, they do. Them and My Dying Bride as well. Also, it's one of those ones where you're watching the show, you're a bit like, you're just, aye, this is done very, very well. So there's big plans for Damnation. I just need to get this year, hold it together, especially those American bands, and make it happen. Because that's basically the past to 2022, because if this year doesn't happen, or this year doesn't happen in the way it's set up at the minute, we lose the rest of the American bands, then there's a bit of a headache. You've got so many people that have bought all these tickets, and do we still need to try and get Pig Destroyer and Wolves in the Throne Room and Bellwitch and Blood Incantation back for next year? Probably. But I'm hoping right here, as we sit right here now chatting, that we can get that the lineup as it is what's going to happen.
Have you, how much information are you getting about what's going on? And have you got a, do you know any more than the average dickhead on the street about, you know, what the potential pitfalls, perils, possibility of having to cancel or anything like that is?
Not in the sense, I mean, I get more information in the sense of where the bands are at each stage. I mean, that's why we lost six bands there and replaced them with Godflesh and Conjurer and the bunch of bands that we did. So I'm getting information from the agents and the bands, because what will happen is people will say, okay, we'll Pig Destroyer on need the US and the UK to work. That's what Pig Destroyer need. They need to be able to fly to the UK, they need to be able to fly back out. Wolves in the Throne Room and Bellwitch and Blood Incantation need the whole of fucking Europe to work, because their whole tour's there. So they're not going to fly in to do one show at Damnation in London. They need to be able to go into Germany and France and Spain and Italy and wherever else that tour goes. So then that's more difficult, because then the agent's dealing with so many moving parts. Like, okay, well, let's say we get to November and France, Germany, Spain, Portugal are fine, but Italy isn't. So is that then, does that cancel the full tour, or is the finance there that they can make those dates up? Will they add something to the UK? Will they take the hit? And then there's just so many if, buts and maybes that you're a bit like, right, okay. So you get, as I sit here right now chatting to you, I'm quite confident about Pig Destroyer. I'm less confident about the Wolves in the Throne Room package. But then I'm quite confident about Mom, because Mom are only going to come across and maybe to the UK. So there's that. And now we've rebuilt the lineup with so many UK bands. I'm quite confident with everything that's already here based. It's like we went after Benediction. Mm-hmm. And I thought Benediction were fucking UK based. But it turns out one guy's in Denmark and one guy's in Italy. So with me and the agent are sitting in backwards and forwards with a fee. And then the guy's like, aye, okay, but I need to get this money to get the guy in for Denmark. And I'm like, well, why are we having this discussion? You're just giving me the exact same headache.
Yeah,
in 2022 when everybody can fly. What's the point of losing whoever I can't even remember the bands we lost now, Eldar and Pallbearer, and replaced them with Benediction? It's giving me the exact same headache.
Yeah.
So that's where we're at. So I'm kept in touch in the loop with the agents and managers quite often. but no, in the sense of the pandemic, I don't have any more information than they.
Dude, well, I will keep my fingers crossed for you, and it has been such a blast talking to you. As I said, we've gone quite a road on this episode.
That's for I know. That went. I don't know how it went from racism and bigotry through the UFC and then back to
and then back to music. That's what happens, mate. I told you, I hit record, and when we see where we go.
Where the conversation goes.
It was interesting hearing about the McGuire thing. I didn't realize that. You know, I would expect that sort of thing in the States, but not yet.
Yeah. Well, as I say, it's got a funky hashtag. So,
like I said, at the end of the day, mate. At the end of the day, you know you are. You know, I know I am, and you know the McGuire dudes made a lot of people very happy that night. So, it beyond that, you know, it is what it is. Like I said, man, absolute blast having you on, and I hope this is not the last time that we do it. So we'll sort something out down the line again.
Perfect. And you get yourself up the road for Damnation then in Accocock, and we'll have a couple of drinks.
For sure, man. Definitely. All right, buddy. Take care of yourself.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. We'll be right back.
Thank you very much to Gavin for coming on the show. And given the fact that he himself is not in a band, I could choose no other than the band we spent quite a bit of time discussing on the podcast. Acrococo with a track called Horns of Baphomet off of Goat of Mendez, which they will be performing in its entirety at the Damnation Festival in November. So make sure that if you don't have tickets for that yet, that you do whatever you need to get hold of some. And I'll have some of the guys from Acrococo on again as well. I know that David has been a hugely requested guest. I have exchanged messages with him, and this is not like Alan Partridge where he's exchanged messages with Roger Moore. We've actually been talking for a while about him coming on. He wants to do it in person, so I finally came up with the brainwave of hiring a studio in Wimbledon, which is hopefully not too far away for him to travel. And then we can record it in person. And I think it'll be something special to do, maybe for episode 100, we'll have to see. But, hopefully I can make that happen. And, I would certainly hope that I get Jason on again at some point as well. And obviously Sam will definitely come back on at some point in the not-too-distant future. So if you don't yet know of Acrococo, then I think you've probably stumbled onto the wrong podcast. There are nothing but gems in their discography. And I know that they will be putting out a new record most likely next year. So we're looking forward to that as well. Speaking of new records, Impaled Nazarene have got a new one out called Eight-Headed Serpent. It follows up the smash hit of 2014, Vigorous and Liberating Death, which followed up the 2010, in my opinion, finest hour of this band, Road to the Octagon. I would also say I was very interested at the response to this album online. It seems a lot of folks have kind of written off the band and say they're boring and feel like they're just getting the same old from the band, which I kind of agree with to a point, maybe, as far as them following a very set formula is concerned. But I would definitely say that, I feel like they're in the ascendancy, quite frankly. If you've been paying attention to their career, I mentioned Vigorous and Liberating Death and Road to the Octagon. Both of those, I think, are two of their best records. I don't think that Eight-Headed Serpent necessarily meets those heights, but it's not far off. And for me, that's, that already makes it worth listening to. Literally from the off, you're going to know that you're listening to an Impaled Nazarene record. The sort of crust punk, hyperspeed black metal mashup that has been the hallmark of their career is very much intact. The goat infatuation is there also, as is all of the other trademarks of this band. And they just, pull all of it off really, really well. They're a band that can write an incredibly speedy, basic song and make it catchy enough to where you're going to want to listen to it again and again. And that's what I found myself doing with this album. I think I listened to it probably over the past weekend about 7 or 8 times in succession, and I didn't get tired of it whatsoever. And kudos to them also for including one of the most unintentionally funny viral video clips. Prophet Ed Citronelli casting out the oral sex demon. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, you're going to hear when I play the first track. But they include that as the intro to the record, which to me just underlines the fact that their fuck off attitude is very much still intact. And again, that to me is it's a welcome antidote to all the heavy social justice nonsense that we have to put up with, which obviously I had a moan with or moan about on the podcast with Gavin. Eight-Headed Serpent, available right now on Osmos Records. It clocks in, I believe, at just under 31 minutes, and it's 31 minutes of pure badassery, as you're going to see from the ironically titled, given the record that I spoke about previously, first track off the album. This is Impaled Nazarene with Goat of Mendez.
Demon came with his penis and put it in my mouth, and then he came again and he slept with me last week, and I told the pastor that I need deliverance again, and since then my private part has been itching.
You've been itching?
Yes.
Get demon! Look at demon! Look! Oral sex, demon! You see oral sex? Look, oral sex! Look! You oral sex! Use oral sex! Let that sperm of that man out! Out! Out, you demon! Out!
Out!
Impaled Nazarene with Goat of Mendez off of Eight Headed Serpent, available right now on Osmos Records. If you heard the song and you liked it, you're going to like the rest of the album. Let's be honest, if you don't like Impaled Nazarene at all and you think that their goat infatuation and their sex songs are beneath you, probably a safe bet that you're not going to enjoy this either. But if you don't, then you will be poorer for it. But anyway, I love it, and I think that it's worth you guys checking out for sure, which is why I brought it up on the show. Right, it is time now for us to pick through some news headlines. And first up on Metal Storm, Allegion finished tracking next full length. Allegion have always felt to me like a band that I should like a whole lot more than I actually do. It says here, Allegion have just completed tracking their next sixth studio album. The sessions took place at Flatline Audio in Westminster, Colorado, with producer Dave Otero. And I don't know what it is that's made me not look into them in more detail. It might be because one half of those two fuckheads that used to do the Metal Sucks podcast, Godless was his name. It might have been because he geeked out so much about them. And I just, everything he likes, I'm just naturally... I'm just naturally opposed to. But anyway, I will check them out a bit more and see if they're worth listening to. But anyway, if you're an Allegion fan, then get ready to be happy because there's a new album on the way. Swallow the Sun, releasing first live album in July. Finnish melodic doom masters Swallow the Sun proudly announced the release of their very first live album entitled 20 Years of Gloom, Beauty and Despair, live in Helsinki. The show for this release, which was filmed and recorded at the Tavastia Club in Helsinki, featured two sets, one acoustic and one fan-voted. Loads of snivelling. Nightwish, a band that I truly do not understand how they continue to feature in on any metal website. I mean, there are fucking pop bands that are edgier than these guys. A Pale Horse Named Death launched new single. I spoke about them last week. A Pale Horse Named Death, of course, featuring Sal, the former drummer of Typo Negative. He used to drum for them all the way up to Bloody Kisses. A Pale Horse Named Death has kind of since been started off as a Typo tribute band. I'm not going to talk again about my feelings about that, but I did listen to this single, and I was pretty underwhelmed. At the Gates reveal new track and video. Speaking of being underwhelmed, you guys know how much I love that last At the Gates single that they released and how much I've loved the last two At the Gates albums. Don't really like this very much. And maybe I need to listen to it a couple more times. Either way, if you haven't checked it out yet, the article here reads, At the Gates are debuting the second single and video of their upcoming album, The Nightmare of Being, to be released July 2nd via Century Media Records. Check out the Paradox track in a video clip directed by Patrick Ulaes, or I don't know how the hell to pronounce his surname. There's just nothing about the song that's particularly interesting to me. The drumming is very basic. The riffing is very much kind of At the Gates by numbers. Whereas the previous song, had a real sort of edge to it, but just something a bit interesting in keeping with the last two releases. This song, I don't know, it just doesn't do it for me. I hope that it's not an indication of what the rest of the record's going to sound like, but we'll see. Chondra, streaming debut record in its entirety. Of course, I shouldn't be speaking about a Season of Mist band because they are NSNB or NSBM. According to Fuckstick, Carcass Bomb, as he's known on Twitter. Anyway, fuck him. Chondra, streaming debut record in its entirety. The lovely Katie Irizarry from Season of Mist told me to check these guys out. Belarusian black metal representatives Chondra are now streaming their debut record, All Occupied by Soul Death. This is very good stuff, and I'll probably review it next week, and I might see whether Katie can get an interview set up with them as well. Speaking of which, I was due to speak to Jarli of Vride in the past week, and I had something that came up that clashed with it. He's very kindly rescheduled, so that's happening this coming week, which means that next week's guest will be Jarli of Vride. So if you like that Vride album, we'll be talking about that and then some on the next episode. By the way, good to see that Season of Mist continued to put out. I mean, just their track record over the last couple of years has just been absolutely exemplary. As far as
consistently putting out phenomenal new music. I mean, again, it's, you know, kind of them and Debo Mamorti are, you know, absolutely on a par for me as far as uncovering quality and releasing quality. Portal, a Vow album available for listening in its entirety. Ahead of tomorrow's official release, Australians Portal offer a full stream of their new album, A Vow. Nathan from Gravier sent me this as well. And I listened to it, but I don't know why I'm not seeing what he is seeing, because he generally has pretty impeccable taste. But I'm struggling to get into this. And again, maybe it's one of those things where one day I'll just listen to it and it'll just click. But for now, it's I'm not feeling it. D. Snyder Detail, new full-length launch first single. Speaking of something that'll never click for me, this fucking poodle-haired nitwit's music will never click, just as his personality never will either. What else is there? Oh, yippee. Machine Head to release 3-track single in 2 weeks. Hooray. Chelsea Wolfe reveals single off Dark Knight's death metal soundtrack. That was also the same soundtrack that featured the new Mastodon single. I listened to this and it is fantastic. Look, I know I had some harsh words for that Miss Piss project, partly because I think that, or Mrs. Piss or whatever that is called, partly because I think it's the stupidest band name I've ever heard. You know, frankly, it is beneath somebody of her talents and class. But this track is phenomenal. So the song is called Diana. If you've not checked it out yet, make sure that you go check out that soundtrack and hear the song. It is absolutely brilliant. Really, as has been all of the last couple of records that she's done. You know, she has a lot of love in the metal scene. She herself is not really metal, in my opinion. But she has more talent in her fucking pinky nail than, I'd say, every single pop star running at the moment. This is a really sad commentary on the state of metal news, that when a band consider releasing a new album, that becomes a headline. Dismember considering releasing new album. I mean, let's be honest too. Dismember were an okay band, but they were never never like a tier one Deicide, Entombed, anything like that. But anyway, so why it has to be a big deal that they're now considering a new album, I don't know. Storm Ruler premiere new lyric video. This I did check out, and I would have reviewed it on this episode as well, but I just didn't have enough time to listen through it, or listen through it properly. Missouri-based black metal duo Storm Ruler premieres a lyric video for the track At the Cliffs of the Azure City, which appears on the on last year's debut full-length Under the Burning Eclipse. The latter will be re-released in several formats by Napalm Records this Friday. So that's why I thought it was a new release. I didn't pick it up last year. I didn't pick up on it last year, I probably should say. But as I said, what I heard, I really liked. So I might talk about it on the show at some point in the nasty distant future. Pestilence, Deificus. I'm going to take a risk and say that's how I pronounce the song title. But anyways, it's the name of the new track. It's just been released. Technical death metal bringers Pestilence have released a music video for Deificus, exclusively premiered by Metal Injection. The song is taken from their upcoming 9th studio album, Exitum, which comes out on June 25th. The first track I heard was brilliant. I'm pretty sure this is going to be brilliant also. One thing to say, though, Patrick Mameli on all the recent photos seems to think that he's tough stuff, when in fact I know he's pretty gym obsessed at the moment, but he's got a really weird build. Like I mean, you know, I can't talk given the fucking pounds I packed on over COVID, but yeah, I don't know. I feel like Kelly's comments about the man having delusions of grandeur stretch into more than just his guitar playing. Tarka set to unleash CD version of tracks from recent split series. As everybody knows, Tarka have been putting out loads of split CDs with Whoredom Rife, Death Cult, Helheim. All of it has been pretty good in my opinion, so they're going to pool all of it together and put it out as one record, and then hopefully they're going to get their arse in gear and do a proper full length. So this story came out last week, right as I was about to post the new episode, so hence why I didn't talk about it. But the controversy continues with Megadeth. They have now decided to part ways with David Ellefson, and David Ellefson, in the meantime, has come out guns blazing, and he is going to be suing whoever released the wanking video as a for I think on the basis of revenge porn. So I would say the fact that he's actually, you know, got the stones to sue this person suggests that, you know, hopefully this was a one and done as far as brain farts are concerned. And, you know, again, considering that this was a situation between consenting adults, as dumb as it was, I'm surprised actually that they fired him. Again, when the news first came out that they'd fired him, I thought that you know, there was more to the story, and that really worried me, because, you know, normally when one of these come out, then yeah, there's usually a slew of it coming out, and the fear for me was that, you know, he was going to be accused of, you know, being a pedophile, and, you know, it would be metal Twitter coming to life in real life. But I think the fact that he's gotten on the front foot with the issue is, you know, I think hopefully a sign that this was just one incredibly dumb thing that he did. So yeah, if he's it's certainly cost him an awful lot. I mean, you know, like I said, no longer in Megadeth. I know he was a salaried member of the band since rejoining, but I would assume that salary would be fairly steep. You know, I just hope again that he manages to pull himself out of this quagmire. That you know, his family, more importantly, doesn't get hurt in the process too bad, or any more than they already have. Because, God, I can only imagine the embarrassment and the shame and how much of a fucking asshole you must feel like if you know a video like that is floating around the internet and your kids can see it. Tied into that story, the first headline that's grabbing my attention on the Democrats' Guide to Rock Music, Blabbermouth, is that Jason Newsted is not joining Megadeth, his wife says. Jason, on that photo, looks like a prepubescent child. But anyway, that aside, former Metallica bassist Jason Newsted will not join Megadeth as David Ellefson's replacement. Ever since Megadeth officially fired Ellefson last Monday, speculation has been rife that Newsted will step in to fill the bassist role in the band's upcoming summer tour with Lamb of God. Earlier today, Jason's wife Nicole said, "Not happening on my watch." I don't know if that's what she said. I'm just too lazy to click on the rest of the link. But you guys know my thoughts on Jason. In his prime, that dude brought so much energy and so much intensity to the Metallica live experience. And it was a real shame for me when he left the band, because I feel like as talented of a bassist as Rob Trujillo is, he's no Jason Newsted. Bathory inducted into Swedish Music Hall of Fame. I guess the Swedish Music Hall of Fame has more cachet to it than does the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which I gave my opinion on a couple of weeks ago. So well done to Bathory. Max Cavalera looks back on Sepultura's Roots album. It's a very courageous record that has aged well. I agree, it has aged quite well, and I do think it was very courageous. You know, I think there's a couple of tracks that are showing signs of the times, and frankly, some that were never very good to begin with, but there are a couple of excellent songs on there. You know, I think that Straight Hate is fucking brilliant. It's one of my gym mainstays. Spit, I think, is very, very cool. You know, there are a couple of really, really cool, songs on there. I think it has aged well. I think that Roots, as an example, is a track that for me sounds a bit better actually when they do it nowadays, and they speed up the song a bit when they play it live, and they've got Derek on vocals. And yes, it was courageous. I do think that it should have been a record that was done as a solo project by Max and Igor, because if you think about it in the context of Sepultura, the same band who did Schizophrenia, Beneath the Remains, and Arise, you can understand why the album got the amount of hate that it got when it came out. And yes, you had Chaos AD as a bridge between the two, but, you know, Chaos AD at its roots was still no pun intended there, was still a, you know, pretty hard proto-thrash record, whereas Roots was just a complete swerve. And I would argue that it was more of a swerve musically for Sepultura than Load was for Metallica when that came out. So I definitely understand where fans were coming from. You know, for me, this is like them doing Roots is not a million miles away from Cannibal Corpse doing a fucking prog album or doing a new metal record. So, you know, I as I said, you kind of, if you look at it in isolation, it's still not a bad record, but it would have been better served as a solo album, in my opinion. You know, I know that that's something that they were really passionate about and they wanted to do. It certainly comes out in the music. But it would be interesting to have known as well what would have happened to the band had that happened. Had they decided to do it as a solo album, would the band still be intact? Probably not, considering the fact that by all accounts it was Gloria who was the fly in the ointment. But I'm not going to keep on talking about that. Again, you all know my views on Sepultura as it is right now. I just personally think that the music that they are making currently is far more interesting than anything that Max has done since he's left Sepultura. Let's see what else there is. Corey Taylor would probably refuse to be inducted into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame if Slipknot got the nod. One thing that he and I actually agree on, which is not often that happens. I struggle to understand why people make such a big deal about things like this. I mean, this to me is it's a mainstream honor, and my thoughts have always been that, you know, metal swims upstream, and metal is at its best when it swims upstream. So to me, to see all of these articles about how it's a fallacy and a criminal injustice that Iron Maiden aren't inducted as an example, I just don't understand why people are getting so wound up about it. Angus Young never had doubts about AC/DC's ability to continue. I mean, I get that. They definitely have lost something without Malcolm being there. It would have been interesting to see, and I mean, the last album, Power Up, isn't too bad. You all know, if you followed the show and you heard my conversation with Kelly T, I'm a Bon Scott man without a doubt. So, you know, for me, the best of AC/DC and the stuff I listen to when I listen to them now is Bon Scott era music. But it would have been interesting to hear what they would have done with Axl Rose, because some of those live shows that they did with him sounded very, very cool. Let's move on. It's not exactly Necrosphere related material, that, although if you don't like AC/DC, you're a fucking douche. Which is the first death metal album, Death, Scream Bloody Gore, or Possessed, Seven Churches? Cannibal Corpse drummer weighs in. I know that Paul Mazurkiewicz here makes the case that it was Scream Bloody Gore, which incidentally turned 34 years old a couple of days ago from when I'm recording this. So happy birthday, Scream Bloody Gore. Fucking fantastic record to this day. I would say that I probably agree with Paul. I think that as much as Jeff Becerra of Possessed was the guy to coin the phrase death metal, I do think that Seven Churches sounds more thrash, and Death, Scream Bloody Gore was really kind of the album that cemented the sound that would kind of, you know, lead to that Florida boom, you know, and frankly to the boom in Sweden as well. And I think as far as the two records are concerned, I think that Scream Bloody Gore sounds a lot better to the, you know, right, or in 2021 than does Seven Churches. And I know there'll probably be a few folks that cry heresy at that, but particularly because it was Scream Bloody Gore's anniversary, or 34th anniversary recently, I gave it a few listens over the last week, and it is still an excellent record. Let's see if there's anything else worth talking about. Yeah, former Exodus frontman Rob Dukes drops new Generation Kill single, Never Relent, featuring Gary Holt. I really liked the Rob Dukes era of Exodus. I thought that some of the stuff that they did on Shovelheaded Killing Machine was brilliant. And I think that he was a very cool frontman for the band as well while he was there. I know, you know, most people will probably always want Zetro to be there, but I never had anything against Rob. Some of the Generation Kill stuff hasn't been too bad. It's, you know, it's not the kind of music I'm going to turn on, you know, on a regular basis, but not bad. Sebastian Bach, thanks Joe Biden for giving us back rock and roll. This is exactly why I take such umbrage to celebrities talking about politics, because there is so much ignorance wrapped up in that one single quote. It is staggering. And I'm not going to go into the reasons why I think that. I'm not going to yell insults at anybody that thinks that Sebastian Bach is right. I would just say this underlines for me the fact that people like Sebastian Bach think entirely based on feeling and emotion, And as much as they, you know, have proclaimed for all of their careers to be these, you know, great independent thinkers and are held up by shitty fucking websites like Blabbermouth as, you know, these rebels and, you know, people that, you know, resist the man and what I don't know what else. They actually are just part of the mainstream, and they parrot the same old crap that you're going to hear on mainstream news media. And for anybody to think that Biden was in any way responsible for giving us back rock and roll, you are a deluded fool, no matter what side of the political aisle you sit on. It's just, you know, and that's not me being partisan. It's not me betraying my Republican allegiance. That is just stating fact. You know, the CDC guidelines were suddenly changed overnight, straight after an article, or straight after several news headlines come out detailing the rising inflation in the US. I mean, if that doesn't strike anybody as odd, I don't know. So, you know, the previous week, you know, the CDC director is talking about, you know, experiencing, you know, visions of doom ahead of the summer, you know, telling people that if they don't mask up, they're killing granny and whatnot. And then cue a couple of negative articles saying that inflation has spiked up to, you know, 4.2% or something like that. And in spite of the fact that there are 7 million vacancies in the country, all the government's helicopter money led to only 240,000 new jobs in, I think this was April. So that you know, really damning news about how poorly this administration's running the economy comes out. And then all of a sudden the next week, all of those CDC guidelines are now a thing of the past. You know, as long as you're vaccinated, you can start unmasking. I mean, it would always have been on the cards for anybody who gets vaccinated to be able to ditch the mask and live their life normally. Otherwise, what is the point of getting the vaccine? But anyways, I'm not going to go down that rabbit hole now. I think I've made my thoughts clear on that. Motley Crue's Nikki Sixx is 95% done with his new book. It says here that as long as all he's waiting on is the next delivery of Crayola to come to his house so he can draw the last couple of pictures. what a fucking loser. Fozzy's Sane music video was filmed on world's longest wooden roller coaster. I've not seen the video. I've not seen the song. I'm pretty sure I won't enjoy it, but I do love me some Chris Jericho. And when I'm done with this, I'm going to watch AEW Double or Nothing, which I am very excited about. AEW, I've said this before, if it weren't for them, I wouldn't watch pro wrestling anymore, but they definitely reinstalled in me a love of pro wrestling that the WWE had done its absolute best to kill off. Cannibal Corpse's Eric Rutan has thought about writing autobiography. He talks on this in this article about, you know, various things that happened to him when he was younger, which I've met Eric, and fantastic conversation. I thought he was a great, great guy. I would love to have him on the podcast again. So if anybody knows him and wants to hook it up, then please do, because going via the record label is not going to happen. I was curious when he spoke about all of these crazy things that supposedly happened to him when he was younger, because he doesn't really let on much of it when you talk to him, and he's quite a sort of stoic dude when you speak to him. Very friendly, but you know, he's very Eric Rutan in person is kind of exactly like I imagined he would be. When you listen to Hate Eternal, and especially when you hear people talk about the experience of working with him at Mana Studios. But I would love to see an autobiography of his. The only bad news is that he said on this article that it would only come out after he's dead. So, and I hope that we have many, many more years of Eric Rutan of a ripping corpse before that happens. Rammstein's Till Lindemann to release I Hate Kids solo single. I saw that Rammstein are starting to announce new shows on social media. There were a couple announced for last year, one in Prague, and I sent my girlfriend a message and said it looks like we're going to Prague next year. This is one band that I want to catch live as many times as possible while I still can. You know, the fact that they're playing again makes me very happy. Final article, and then I'm going to be done with this shit. Satyricon exhibition, Satyricon and Munch to explore intersection of black metal and visual art. I'm in two minds about whether to be excited about this or whether to think this is anything other than just a fucking waste of time. But anyways, Norwegian black metal veterans Satyricon have teamed up with Munch Museum for an upcoming exhibit set to open in Oslo, Norway in early 2022. The exhibition Satyricon and Munch explores the intersection of black metal and visual art, where a specially composed musical work is connected with a selection of Edvard Munch's images. When you enter the hall on Munch Museum's 10th floor, this exhibition will create an atmosphere that opens up new entrances to Munch's work and to Satyricon's music. So some Satyricon music is going to play in the background while you look at artworks by a guy whose artwork, in my opinion, is fine, but it's not exactly black metal. Anyway, as you can imagine, Satyr is very excited about this, blah, 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 the end. So that is it for news for this week, ladies and gentlemen. That means that it is the end of another installment of Into the Necrosphere. If you've made it this far, thank you very much. And again, you know, if you listen to this podcast week in and week out, I cannot stress to you how blown away I am by that, because there are so many metal podcasts around. There's so many podcasts generally. I mean, every fucking celebrity with, you know, five things to say has a podcast. You know, there's a bunch of really, really cool stuff to listen to. And if you listen to this, you know, I really, really appreciate it. And it makes it worth me doing this week in and week out. And I genuinely do thoroughly enjoy this. It's got its ups and downs like everything. But for the most part, I can't get enough of it. And I cannot thank all of you enough. Next week, hopefully, Jarli of Ride will be the guest. And I've got a couple of others lined up as well, including the guitar or the former bassist for a band I'm about to play. So another band that Gavin and I spoke about on the podcast, Stampin' Ground. And if you were in London in the early 2000s and you caught these guys open for a myriad of bands, you would have soon discovered that not only did they open for some serious heavyweights, but they also put a lot of heavyweights to very serious shame with the shows that these guys used to put on. I mean, it was a fucking guaranteed recipe for carnage when these guys got up on stage. And again, I think back to those times, and I keep on thinking that I wish I could travel back in time and tell myself to savor every moment, because frankly, those were some of the best experiences that I ever had, particularly at a live show. So Ian Glasper, of course, is the bassist I was referring to. Hopefully he's going to come on to talk a bit about Stamping Ground and to talk about those halcyon days of the London metal hardcore scene. In the meantime, I'm going to play a track that didn't actually feature Ian, but features heavily on my gym playlist. You'll understand why from the title. This is Stamping Ground with Pain is Weakness Leaving the Body. Thank you very much, everybody, once again. Keep it real on the streets. Stay safe and healthy, and I will see all of you motherfuckers next week. Yeah.
Outstrip my follow. What follow?